Okay. Well, why don't we get started then? Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you all very much for coming. My name is Richard Samuels. I'm the director of the Center for International Studies here at MIT and a professor in the Department of Political Science. Sadly, we've been here before. Some of you might remember that the center organized a public forum immediately after 9/11, and that we held another one immediately after 3/11, which was the catastrophe in Japan that claimed 20,000 lives in a matter of minutes. Our purpose then, in those meetings, as our purpose now, is to share what we know and to provide, if we can, a fuller context for the community on a crisis that affects us all. But this time, it really is different. This is a different event, a different kind of crisis. It was more personal for us here in Cambridge than any of us, I think, dared imagine. We meet today in the very near shadow of a great personal loss and unaccustomed terror at the marathon finishing line across the river, at the hospitals nearby, at the Stata Center, which is just steps away from this spot on this campus, and in the streets and in the shops by our homes. We've all been touched very directly and very deeply, first by terrorism and then by heroism. Before we begin then, I thought I'd like to ask you to join me in a moment of silence, just to remember those who we've lost and to reflect for a moment on the suffering that continues for many in our community. Thank you very much. Now, some of what we've experienced has been clarified by the media and by analysts elsewhere. Still, we deserve and we want to know more. We need a context, I think, for what's been visited upon us. So as in those earlier cases, those earlier symposia, what we're going to try to do this afternoon is to bring a fuller perspective on the politics that may have shaped the views of those two young men who are accused, the one survivor who is accused of perpetrating a crime of mass terror, and the politics that are likely to be operating on others, both here and abroad. And I'm very grateful to the colleagues we've assembled here for agreeing to come together to help us reach these understandings and get this fuller understanding. Let me introduce them to you. What we're going to do is simply go straight down the line with presentations from each before we then turn it over to you for questions from the audience. So I will introduce them in order on the front end. Stephen Van Ever, immediately to my left, is the Ford International Professor of Political Science at MIT. He works on US foreign policy and international relations of the Middle East. Elizabeth Wood, who sits to his left, is a professor of history at MIT, an expert in the field of Soviet history. Her work centers on the performance of power under Vladimir Putin. Carol Saivetz, next in line, is a research affiliate here at the Security Studies Program in the Center for International Studies, again at MIT. She's written widely on Russian policy in the Middle East and on other Soviet successor states. Bakyt Beshimov is a visiting scholar at the MIT Center for International Studies, and he's deputy chairman of the Social Democratic Party of Kyrgyzstan. Peter Krause, to his left, is an assistant professor of political science at Boston College. He's, we're proud to say, a graduate of the MIT Political Science Department and a research associate here at the CIS, at the Center for International Studies. He studies international security, Middle East politics, non-state violence, and social movements. To his left, Jeanne Guillemin is senior advisor at the MIT Security Studies Program. We're all in some way or other associated with the Security Studies Program at CIS. Jeanne's a member of the World Economic Forum's Global Agenda Council on WMD and works on issues regarding infectious diseases and biological weapons. She's going to speak to us about the FBI and the way it works in crises such as this. And last but certainly not least, Silvia Dominguez is an associate professor of sociology at Northeastern University and an expert on immigration integration, on race and ethnic relations, on social networks, violence, and mental health. With those introductions, I want to turn it over to Steve and turn him to you. Thank you.
Great. Thanks, Dick. I teach classes on American foreign policy and on the causes and prevention of war, and so I'm going to focus my comments basically on what caused this attack at the marathon and what policies we might think about implementing to prevent the recurrence of an attack like this, sort of think of practical terms. Where did it come from, and what could be done to minimize the odds of similar attacks down the road? And I'm going to make 3 points. The first is, this attack was in important ways caused by the Al-Qaeda narrative. It happened because the Al-Qaeda narrative still lives in the wider Muslim world, and I believe attacks like this are going to continue as long as that narrative is widely believed and repeated. It's not very widely believed and repeated, but it is sufficiently widely repeated and believed to cause events like this, and the U.S. hasn't taken the narrative piece of the problem very seriously in the past and should do it. Second is that this attack emerged from a horrible regional war, the Russian-Chechen war, and the brutality that the Russian state has inflicted on Chechnya. It illustrates the fact that the United States has an interest in peace, that wars, especially wars involving the Muslim world, but wars anywhere in the world, are gasoline for terror groups. The United States should understand that pursuing peace in whatever way is effective should be a piece of our counterterror policy. Peace should be part of national security, peace promotion. The third is that I think it's possible that this attack emerged in part because the United States and Russia are not cooperating closely on these security matters. And I think that that's happened in part because the U.S. government has chosen to adopt policies that have frayed and disrupted U.S.-Russian security cooperation in the past, including U.S.-NATO expansion, talk of further expanding NATO into the Caucasus region, national missile defense. And I think we should understand we pay a price for these policies, and we may have paid a price for it at the marathon bombing. I'm an advocate of close U.S. cooperation with all the world's major states against what I think are the biggest security problems in the world: proliferation spread, WMD terror, climate change, threats to the world's natural environment. I believe that the world's major powers all share a common interest in dealing with these problems, and the threats we pose to each other are much smaller. So and I think this event illustrates that you pay a price if you think that playing hardball with other major powers should be the main focus of foreign policy. I think that's old think. That worked for the 20th century. We ought to rethink it for the 21st. So just to run through these ideas in slightly more detail, the narrative point. Al-Qaeda today is a fragmented organization with a central core that lives on in northwest Pakistan, but is much weakened. It's only a tiny shadow of its former self. About five, depending on how you count, regional organizations that are in better shape institutionally. The strongest one is in Yemen, so-called AQAP, Al-Qaeda in the Arab Peninsula. But there also are franchise organizations in Somalia, Iraq, Mali, northern Nigeria, and we see a growing Al-Qaeda organization in Syria. And most talk about the terror problem sort of thinks in terms of dismantling those organizations. I think this attack did not emanate from any of them. It emanated from self-radicalizing folks in the United States who found the Al-Qaeda narrative on the internet and decided to believe it, which illustrates the broader point, which is that the, quote, war on terror or war on Al-Qaeda, whatever you want to call it, must have an idea piece to it. And that piece has been missing ever since 9/11. The United States government has not taken seriously the mission of addressing and pushing back or defeating the Al-Qaeda narrative. Now, the Al-Qaeda narrative, what is it? It's essentially a victim narrative that argues that the last 100 years, or in another version of it, the last 1,000 years, have seen unrelenting, unprovoked, and immensely destructive onslaught by the non-Muslim world, especially the Christian world, but also the Hindu world, against the Muslim world. So there's a picture here of a wholly innocent Muslim world behaving itself perfectly and under unprovoked attack by others. And the more modern examples that are cited of this attack would be the war in Bosnia, which bin Laden cited a lot, the war in Somalia, the U.S. intervention there in 92, which is cited as an aggressive act in this narrative, the Western efforts to free East Timor, support for East Timorese independence from Indonesia, which is cited as a tearing apart of Indonesia, and of course the U.S. attack on Iraq, and of course Israeli conflict with the surrounding Arab states and the Palestinians. And then if you go back in history, previous Muslim-Christian conflicts are also cited as part of this narrative. Is the narrative true? Well, some of this aggression is, you know, shall I say, spun quite a bit. In Bosnia, the U.S. was actually fighting on the Muslim side against Christians. But nevertheless, there's plenty of Christian, you know, Muslim blood on Christian hands that's been accumulated down through the centuries. The main error in the narrative is what it omits, that it omits that this has been a two-sided conflict and that down through the ages, Muslims in general and Islamists in particular have also sort of given as well as they've gotten. If you look at the Islamist record in Sudan, roughly 2 million South Sudanese have been killed by the Islamist jihadi, whatever you want to call, regime in Khartoum. Likewise in Afghanistan. So it's the sound of one hand clapping. It's a false narrative, mostly false by what it omits. But it's a very compelling narrative, very compelling. And the U.S. government has made very little effort to answer it, argue against it, refute it. The whole U.S., if you will, public diplomacy activity today is pallid. It's top folks have not been recruited to lead it. The amount of money spent on it is tiny. There's no really professionalized core of folks who conduct public diplomacy in the U.S. government that that exists as a sort of separate career line. During the 1990s, Congress, under the leadership of Jesse Helms, dismantled the USIA, which was the main arm for sort of public arguing overseas, and that function then was put in a place where it couldn't thrive very well. So my main point here is I think this idea piece, the need to address the al-Qaeda narrative, is essential, and the U.S. government has made a big mistake in not addressing it so far. Now, you can counter-argue and say, well, how can the U.S. engage in an argument about sort of Mideast politics, given that the U.S. has been an aggressive actor, isn't the right religion, has misdeeds to its name, you know, it's not a legitimate player in the whole debate. And we can argue about whether U.S. public diplomacy could be effective. But I think the history, especially the 40s and 50s, shows that in the past when the U.S. decided to focus on that activity, the U.S. has been successful at it. And to my mind, this neglect of the idea piece is part of a larger, if you will, militarization of U.S. Approaches to the terror problem. This, the sort of one bumper sticker to take away is that the American approach to the terror problem is too militarized. Second point is that this conflict, this attack rather, emerged from, it's not an accident in my opinion, it emerged from Chechnya, which is a place which has seen immense violence over the last 20 years. The Russians have committed tremendous violence against the Chechen people in two wars in the 1990s, just destroying vast swaths of the country and killing enormous numbers of people. Chechnya was earlier ravaged by Stalin in the Second World War when the entire population was deported, and I'm forgetting the percent who were killed, but it was, I once knew, it's like a fifth. And then in the 1850s, earlier, when the Russians conquered the place, they inflicted huge violence on the place. The more recent violence, though, had a particular effect. It gave al-Qaeda an in into the country. We saw in Chechnya what we've seen in some other places, which is whoever's losing a civil war is willing to make friends with really bad people out of desperation and accept their help. in Afghanistan. We saw the Taliban willing to invite al-Qaeda in the 1990s because the Taliban was having a tough time in their war against the Northern Alliance, and they needed al-Qaeda's military help and their expertise and their money, so they allowed them to come in and develop bases. And it was from those bases that they organized the 9/11 attack. Same thing happened in Chechnya. The Chechens were desperate for help against the Russian attack and allowed al-Qaeda folk to join them in their effort, and this gave the al-Qaeda operatives an opportunity to infest the society and make friends and influence people, and to recruit Chechens into al-Qaeda conflict elsewhere, especially in South Asia. This argument, it's part of a larger argument that one of our MIT PhD students has made. I think it's a terrific thesis that she's writing. Stephanie Kaplan is writing a dissertation arguing that wars anywhere are gasoline for al-Qaeda. Al-Qaeda, especially if they involve Muslims, al-Qaeda loves to use wars anywhere involving Muslims for propaganda, but also for networking as occasions to enter into a war scene, make new friends, develop new contacts, extend their organizational reach, for training also, and for fundraising also. And my deduction from all that is the United States should have a peace policy toward any conflict, especially conflicts involving Muslims. The United States should see it as a part of its war on terror to promote Arab-Israeli peace, to promote India-Pakistan peace in Kashmir, do its best, I think we've done a lousy job of it, do its best to leave Iraq in a peaceful state and to calm other conflicts in the region. And if you want to ask me about Syria, that's a conflict today that I think has no easy answer, but if there were one, we should pursue it. My third point is that I'm guessing this is really, I'm more, on much shakier ground here, but when I look at the structure of what happened over the last several years involving the Tsarnaev family, we know the Russians did not fully cooperate with the United States on this case from the get-go. When the Russians queried the U.S. to run the Tsarnaevs through their files, they didn't explain why. And when the U.S. went back to the Russians and asked them, why are you guys curious about the Tsarnaevs, they didn't answer. Which illustrates to me, lack of tight intelligence cooperation. Then we know that later, the elders and I went back to Dagestan, and it's a bit odd. We haven't heard, weren't the Russians watching, following, learning things? Certainly they didn't communicate anything they did learn to the USA. And to me, my observation on that is, yeah, and what do you expect? U.S. relations with Russia, not too good. The U.S. has been sort of pursuing a hardball policy toward Russia since the 90s with, as I said, the two policies I think you should question the most are NATO expansion, which I think was a terribly unwise thing to do, further talk of NATO expansion into the Caucasus, into the idea of including Ukraine and Georgia, which I think would be very unwise, and then national missile defense. So to my mind, there's a price for not pursuing full détente with other powers, and I think we may have paid it. So I will stop there and let Elizabeth Wood add some thoughts.
Hard act to follow. Okay, so this is a very complicated topic, and we don't have all the information yet, right? We know that there's a lot of pieces we don't know. Yesterday in the Boston Globe, veteran reporter Kevin Cullen, whose work I like a lot, said, "You may have noticed I'm not using the Tsarnaev brothers' first names. That's because I'm in the process of forgetting them. I don't want to remember their names. I want them to vanish from my memory bank." He said he wanted to remember instead the victims. Today, I want to work a little bit with the story of Tamerlane and Jahar Tsarnaev, of Anzor and Zubaydat, the parents, not as individuals. We don't know enough. I've been, searching to see what we could find out, but as part of a history that we need to know. Unless we understand the perpetrators of violence as individuals situated in history, as individuals situated in causes and conditions that are larger than their own biographies, we cannot understand what happened last week at the Boston Marathon. I want to use the story of these two young men as a window to understand this difficult and troubled part of the world. And of course, I'm going to be joined very much by Carol Saivetz, who's going to talk about the last 20 years in more detail, and Bakyt Beshimov, who is actually from Kyrgyzstan and can talk about the situation in the region from a firsthand perspective. But let me do, as a veteran teacher, my students have been fascinated. We stopped all other discussion after the bombings to say, let's talk about what happened. What I want to start with is a map, because I think unless we understand the geography, there's a lot we won't understand. My main theme is going to be to understand the difficulties of this. Oops, sorry. I went back. It's not supposed to happen. To understand the difficulties of this region caught between, at the edge of Russia, with resources that everybody wants, and as a crossroads up in the mountains. So first, let me see how I do this. First, we need to see that Chechnya and Dagestan are between the Black Sea and the Caspian Sea. This is a close-up of the region. You can see the sheer number of different aouls, villages, cities, towns. This is a region with if you actually count them properly, some 20 different nationalities with languages that are not even cognate to each other. The scientists, I always say to my students, I don't know if this is actually true linguistically, it's a little bit like different species of squirrels. When you live in the high mountains, it's very easy to develop different linguistic patterns. Here's the geography, and you can see that the mountains lead from Sochi in the west, which is a not insignificant part of the story, I'm convinced, all the way practically to Baku in the far east, another oil capital. And then the other thing I want to show you is that while Chechnya is fairly ethnically homogeneous, Dagestan is one of the least ethnically homogeneous, most heterogeneous places in the world, and one of its problems in this post-Soviet period is trying to deal with the fact that they've got 10, 20 different nationalities in a very small area. So what I want to talk about today is a little bit of the back history, since I've got esteemed colleagues who can talk more about the current history, of the Russian North Caucasus conflict. The other thing I didn't say is that these mountains are 18,000 feet high. These are some of the highest mountains in the world. They're higher than the Alps. They're extremely difficult to cross, and there's only a few key passes. And the other thing I want to say is that in terms of religion, the North Caucasus has historically been Muslim since the 18th century. We have earlier roots, but what's important is that especially Chechnya and Dagestan were Sufi Muslims. In other words, Sufism was a spiritual religion, and a political religion in the sense that the head of state was an imam, but it was not an expansionist, it was not a radical, it was not a violent religion. It was a contemplative religion. So we'll talk about that. The tension between the Russians and the Chechen and the North Caucasians goes back as far as Peter the Great. I like to think of it in a way as a tension between the peoples of the steppe, the flatlands. The Russians live in the forest in the far north, and then adapted to the steppe in the 15th, 16th centuries as they began to push back the Mongols and the Tatars and the other peoples of this region. The mountain lifestyle is very different. It's based on clans and loyalties. The two regions have been coming into conflict both over territory and sovereignty, which we also need to talk about, and also over oil and gas. As it turns out, the region right above Grozny has an oil field. I wonder if there were not oil right here and also right up here, might they be more willing to let it go if there were not oil?
And the Nazis also were going for the oil when they came in. Peter the Great had begun a push toward the south after he had, his main great success, as I always tell my students, was to get the Northern Sea and build St. Petersburg. He hoped to get to the southern part. He couldn't. At that point, it was still controlled by many different migratory peoples. It's really the Tsars Alexander I and Nicholas I, who began in the early 19th century, who engaged in what were called the Caucasian Wars, or sometimes the Murid Wars. Muridism is the is a Sufi term that means the committed one, which means from a root of willpower or self-esteem. And a Murid is one who follows a teacher on a spiritual path. So again, we see that even the wars had a spiritual dimension, as the Chechens, the Dagestanis, the Avars, all the peoples of this region attempted to defend themselves against what they felt were the incursions of the Russians. I think it's interesting that the Russian Empire was able to annex Georgia and Armenia and parts of Azerbaijan before they were able to annex the Northern Caucasus. Georgia was annexed in 1801, Armenia in 1828. Parts of this region were annexed in the 1810s, but Chechnya held out till the death of Imam Shamil in 1859. The capture of Shamil in 1859. So it's also interesting that when you study, if Russians talk about their history, what they remember is the War of 1812, when they beat Napoleon, the great superpower of the day. They were not at this time able to beat the smaller nations of the Caucasus because of the terrain, because of the distances, and because of the fierce fighting and deep antithesis between the two. The other thing that's interesting, and I'm not an expert on this, but I'll just tell you what some other scholars have said, is that there's a way in which the Murid Wars, these wars to get control of this region, brought together Islam and religious nationalism as a unifying force in a way that hadn't been true before. That what these republics, these regions that all spoke different languages, begin to realize is that what they have in common is Islam. And they begin to fight back on those grounds. The flip side, unfortunately, is that the Russians bring to this 19th century a profound sense of mission, of their own role as Christians, as Orthodox, as the Third Rome. That's part of their great claim to rule, to convert. The story of the conversion is very complicated, but they were definitely massively trying to convert these peoples to Orthodoxy. And it became so ingrained in the culture that when I was in 12th grade and in studying Russian from an emigre, I learned a song by Lermontov, the great Russian poet, called the Cossack Lullaby, that begins, sleep, my little one, sleep, my baby. When you grow up, you will be a great Cossack. You will lead the people. And it has a very sweet melody. If I wasn't intimidated, I would sing it for you. I do for my classes. But the scary part is it then goes on to say, it's the nanny singing. When you grow up, you'll leave, and I will cry for you in secret tears, because I will wave bravely, but I will cry secret tears. And then you will be in at the Terek River, and the evil Chechen will crawl onto the banks of the river with the dagger in his teeth. So children grew up hearing this lullaby, which is very sweet and says, Bayushki Bayu, go back to sleep, my little one, go to sleep, go to sleep, hearing about the evil Chechen crawling onto the banks. And this means that the Russian, and today in Moscow and Petersburg, the police are constantly checking for passports for people from the Caucasus, but it's not a new racism, as the Mike point. There's an older piece to it that, of course, is much deepened by the conflicts of the 1990s. There are two great works of literature for anybody who's interested, one of which I teach. One is Haji Murad by Tolstoy, which is a great anti-war declaration. And the other is Lermontov's Hero of Our Time. The Soviets had made Chechnya into a so-called autonomous republic after they had declared their independence. World War II, the Germans were heading for Grozny. What they wanted was oil for their military operations. They got as far as Maikop, but then were pushed back in 43. The sad thing is that at the end, at that point, there had been some uprisings, but Stalin declared that the entire Chechen people were responsible, the entire Ingush people, the Karachai people, all of the peoples of the North Caucasus, and he instituted what in English is known as Operation Lentil. And the reason it was called Operation Lentil was that the Russian word for lentils is chechevitsa. It's an ordinary food. It's a you know, the lentil, brown lentils. Chechevitsa, his Operation Chechevitsa was to get the Chechens and to get the English. They were deported 480,000 Chechens, plus about 200,000 other North Caucasians were deported in trucks and boxcars, the same kinds of boxcars that the Nazis used in against the Jews and Gypsies and homosexuals. About 20 to 25% of the population died en route and under the terrible conditions when they arrived. Some 100,000 of the Chechens arrived, went to Kyrgyzstan, more than went to Kazakhstan, but some went to Kyrgyzstan. It wasn't until 1957 that Nikita Khrushchev let them go back. So one other quick thing I want to do is take a quick look at the Tsarnaya family, which it's too much to do in the time I have, but what we do know, putting this together, is that I think the first fact is not quite right. We don't know where the Tsarnaya family were deported to. An early source I saw thought they went to Kyrgyzstan. It's a little less clear than that. What we do know is that the parents of Tamerlane and Jakhar moved around constantly, at least from according to Kyrgyz sources that I was looking at, Russian sources. They seem to have started out in Kalmykia, which is just to the north of Dagestan and Chechnya, where the parents were at university. The father is Chechen, the mother is Avar, another ancient people of the region. Tamerlane was born in Kalmykia. The family probably then moved to Kyrgyzstan, where Jakhar was born in 1993. But they also moved, they were in Chechnya at one point in there. They may have been in Dagestan even then in 2000. Then in 2001, they go to Dagestan. Jakhar doesn't even get to finish first grade. In March of 2002, the parents take him to the States. The brother and two sisters seem to have stayed. It's not the details that matter. It's the fact that in those years, as we'll hear more when Carol tells us, 1990s, the reason they left Chechnya, assuming that the sources are correct and that's where they were, was because of the violence. That's what drove them to Kyrgyzstan, which at the time was going through its own impoverishment, struggles to get started. And in 1995, there was a famous incident in Dagestan, the Budyonovsk hospital crisis. So there's been sort of crisis after crisis of moving from nationalism to where the region, the thing to say about this region is that much of the initial fight for independence from the Russians had to do with nationalism. And later, it had more to do, I would argue, with it becomes an Islamic war precisely because of the weakness that Stephen Evera was just telling you about. Makhachkala becomes known for its weekly shootouts, for its murders. We've just had five Islamic radicals have been shot by the Russian authorities in the last week. So the thing I want to end on, the note I want to end on, is to think about the ways Russia may respond. Will they use this as an excuse in advance of the Sochi Olympics, which are 10 months away? February 2014, we will see the beginning of the Olympics. Might the, you know, to what extent will they then be saying, oh yes, it's like what they did in after 9/11 was to say, oh yes, we share this common bond around terrorism, so we have to share this bond around the new terrorism, and now you will understand us and you will condone violence. And I would say to that, that there are two things. One is we must not give in to those who say that this 19-year-old who's been dragged around should be treated as an enemy combatant. He had U.S. citizenship. And we must not give in to the saber rattlers who say we need another war. And we must not give in to saying, oh yes, Russia should have a free hand. It's not, there's probably not much we can do, but we should keep an eye on them because the human rights issues will be, maybe, may well be significant. So, turn over to Carol. Too short.
You know, we academics never have enough time to say what we want to say. Without much planning, what I have to say actually follows beautifully from what Steve and Elizabeth have already talked about. You know, we didn't know, Elizabeth and I did, but the average American citizen did not know a lot about Chechnya. We may have heard about the wars in the 90s. We didn't pay much attention to it. And I'm hoping that what I can say will give some context to what we've all been reading in the paper. I think some of it's been outright wrong. I heard one guy on MSNBC tell me that Chechnya was in the middle of Central Asia, which is Elizabeth's map, show us it's not. And at least it hasn't been nuanced enough. But I have to say that my first reaction was, oh my God, the Chechen wars have come to Boston. The Chechens, as Elizabeth has talked about, are a fiercely independent peoples. They resisted the czars, they resisted the Soviets, and now they've resisted Vladimir Putin and the post-Soviet military. And as Elizabeth has told us, it's not only the Chechens, but other groups of peoples in the North Caucasus who have been resilient and have resisted the sort of Russianization and the Sovietization of the area. And even when they were defeated, the Chechens maintained their sort of resiliency and their independent spirit over the years. As Elizabeth also mentioned, Joseph Stalin saw the Chechens as bandits who continued to raid in the region and everything, and some 35,000 Chechens were purged. This is before the deportations. Were purged in 1933, and another 14,000 were purged in the late 1930s. But as both Steve and Elizabeth have alluded to, there were these mass deportations in the beginning of 1944. They were deemed to be untrustworthy peoples and therefore shipped off quite literally to Kazakhstan and to Kyrgyzstan. Which is why, as Elizabeth said, we think the Chernaya family wound up in Kyrgyzstan, at least for part of its time. They were permitted to return under Khrushchev in the late 1950s. And I think it's also important, and I want to emphasize what Elizabeth already said, that a lot of the Chechens are Sufi. Sufism is a kind of mysticism. They are not Salafists. They are not radical Islamists. But as Steve alluded to, I think that radical Islam has sort of taken hold in part of it. When the Soviet Union collapsed, Chechnya declared its independence. And there was this anomalous period between 1991 and 1994, when the first Chechen war began, where Chechnya was independent, conducting a foreign policy, conducting its own affairs. And Yeltsin and his entourage basically did nothing about it. Now, what you have to realize is that this was a period in which Yeltsin was trying to consolidate his hold on power in the Russian Federation, which, by the way, is composed of 89 regions and autonomous oblasts. And Yeltsin famously told the leaders of all of these republics, they're like the states of the United States, to take as much sovereignty as you could swallow. And some of the other Muslim republics within the Russian Federation said, okay, we're going to, you know, basically be quasi-independent, much more autonomous. Tatarstan at this point was a great success. And Chechnya, for whatever reasons, was then invaded by the Russians at the end of 1994. I've never heard a satisfactory explanation as to why, for the first 3 years of post-Soviet Russia, Chechnya was allowed to sort of exist in this limbo status, and all of a sudden, the Russians sent in the troops. There's one theory that there were fighting among clans in Chechnya, and the representative of one of the clans was part of Yeltsin's entourage, and so he egged them on to go in to try to settle scores locally. And Pavel Grachev, who at that point was the defense minister, also is famously quoted as saying, "Ach, it'll take a week and we're going to mop up." Didn't quite work out that way. I should mention as well that the first post-Soviet president of Chechnya was Dzhokhar, not the name, Dudayev, who who was actually a Soviet military hero of the Afghan wars. And given the time frame, I'm not surprised, or I'm surmising here, I don't know, that Dzhokhar Tsarnaev was named after this Chechen hero at the time. So this first war was a violent war. Basically, they destroyed beautiful downtown Grozny. I'm joking. I'm being a little sarcastic here. But in effect, the Russian army could not subdue the area, and they basically withdrew with their tails between their legs. And when they withdrew in 1996, there was a peace plan in place. They were supposed to give money to the Chechens to rebuild what had been destroyed. And in 2000, there was supposed to be a referendum on independence for Chechnya, neither of which happened. I have to tell a personal story here. At some point in the mid-90s, there was this really crazy lady running around the Boston area who somehow got hooked up with the Chechens and claimed that she was a representative of the Chechen people in the United States. So sitting at Harvard, it was what was then the Russian Research Center, a bunch of us sat in a room with a telephone hookup to Dzhokhar Dudayev. And I remember asking him, each of us got a chance to ask a question. I remember asking him, well, do you regret having sort of fought for independence as opposed to taking the path that Tatarstan did? And he said, absolutely. If only he had known, he would have pursued a very different course, which I thought was very sad because he was eventually assassinated by Russian authorities because he liked to use his cell phone a little too much and they could track him. And the next Chechen leader was also assassinated by the Russian. Now, between 1996, which is the end of the first Chechen war, and 1999 into 2000, the beginning of the second, Chechnya basically dissolves into total anarchy. There is infighting among clans. There is infighting among Salafists, among Sufis, among secular nationalists, etc. And some of this was actually encouraged by outside Islamist forces, which brings me to agree pretty much with what Steve says. We know that jihadis from the Middle East, particularly a guy named Khattab, who was a Jordanian, went in and helped the Chechens. And the Chechens went to other places to fight. And now we know there are some Chechens fighting with the rebels in Syria. Just a contemporary note there. At the same time, if you go back and look at newspapers, there were beheadings. There were kidnappings. Kidnapping became a big business in Chechnya at the time. So in the summer of 1999, some Chechen Islamists went and invaded Dagestan next door. Elizabeth, I'm so glad you brought maps. Allegedly to help Islamist forces there that were fighting against the Russians. But one thing that Elizabeth didn't mention is that there were mysterious bombings of apartment buildings in Moscow in the summer of 1999. The KGB or the FSB alleged that it was perpetrated by Chechens. There are still rumors to this day, if you look at some of the even the Russian press coverage, but certainly the Western press coverage, that this was actually engineered by the FSB, the successor to the KGB, because this was just as Vladimir Putin was becoming first prime minister and then acting president as Yeltsin stepped aside. And the working hypothesis of people who allege this is that the Chechen war was going to be a chance for Putin to burnish his credentials and show that he was a great nationalist for the Russian people against these dastardly Chechens whom the Russians have been fighting for centuries. Putin's conduct of the war was even more ruthless than his predecessors. But this time, I guess we could say the Russians were successful. By 2007, give or take, the war basically petered out, but not before the Chechens took the fight to other parts of Russia and to Moscow itself. There was the siege of the hospital that Elizabeth alluded to. There was the theater siege, if you can think back into the early 2000s. There was Beslan, which was the school siege in 2004. There have been bombings in Pushkin Square in Moscow. There have been bombings in the Russian metro, etc. But the war ended with a Putin ally, Mr. Kadyrov, being in charge. They basically pacified and have rebuilt the area. The irony to me is that here is Kadyrov, Putin's ally, now talking about implementing Sharia law, which Putin's not very happy about, in Chechnya. But with Chechnya pacified, the insurgency has spread to Dagestan and even further afield into some of the other little territories in that part of the world. It's kind of a low-level insurgency, but the targets are, you know, there are bombings all the time. Police stations, local authorities, and until very recently, also civilians both there and again in Moscow. If you think back to 2011, there was a major bombing in the arrivals terminal at Domodedovo Airport, which is the one I always fly into. And when I was there afterwards, you could definitely see the remnants of the attack. The interesting thing, and here I think we can argue that that what happened in Boston is not a direct result of what was happening there, is that the head of this Islamist insurgency in the North Caucasus in 2012 called for the cessation of all attacks against civilians. So this war is still going on, but the targets are now only police stations and authorities and stuff like that. There's not this arbitrary taking of hostages in other places. So what I want to do with the time I have left is to talk a little bit about what this means for U.S.-Russian relations and try to answer the question about whether we should care what's going on in the North Caucasus or not. The first thing to note is that when 9/11 happened, Putin seized the opportunity to say to us, okay, we're now in the same boat, basically. You have your terrorists, we have our terrorists, and he hoped that the West would stop criticizing the conduct of the war in Chechnya. There are, of course, links to international terrorism. Steve's mentioned some of this. There were some of the so-called Afghansi who went to Chechnya to fight, and the Chechens are now in Syria, apparently. And Ayman Zawahiri, his name I can never pronounce, also apparently traveled to the North Caucasus in the mid-1990s and was arrested by the Dagestani authorities on visa violations for 6 months. Some scholars note that among the Islamist literature and everything of the region is anti-Semitism, anti-Westernism. Some say that the people in the region, those who were involved in the fighting, believe that there were two Satans, Russia and the United States. But other people argue that this insurgency is really local. The issue is independence, the issue is sovereignty, the issue is sort of Russia get out and leave us alone. It really has nothing to do with the other wars that are going on. The Boston events have also raised questions, as Steve mentioned, about intelligence sharing between Russia and the United States. The Russians weren't forthcoming, even after they asked the FBI to check up on these guys. And if they were so suspicious, why the hell did they let Tamerlane go back to Dagestan for 6 months, not arrest him, and not do anything about it? One of the problems, apparently, is that the local authorities, the Russians multiply these intelligence agencies, that they don't talk to each other. I mean, we have some problems with that, too, but they don't seem to talk to each other. The deputy head of the Security Council of Dagestan said that Tsarnaev had spent only 4 days there. Now, we know he was there, give or take, 6 months. He did apparently meet with one of the known local recruiters, a guy whose name is Mahmoud Nidal, and the latter was killed in an anti-terrorist raid in 2012 while Tamerlane was in Dagestan. The interesting thing, and here we get some sensitivity, is that the Chechen leader Kadyrov has condemned the attacks in Boston. The Chechen leader in exile, because they don't get along with each other, also condemned the attacks. But this is a big deal for both Russia and the United States. Russia is hosting the Olympics in Sochi, which is on the Black Sea, so it's really in that region, it's very close to it. And this was an attack on an open sporting event. So there are parallels, in a sense, to the Olympics, and I think Russia's got to be very careful about what happens in Sochi in next year. Apparently, within the last couple of weeks, there's been enhanced intelligence cooperation between the United States and Russia. Obama and Putin spoke on the phone the other day. They agreed that their intelligence services cooperate, and Obama said yesterday at his press conference that the suspicion that exists between the two services was declining. Now, where I think I disagree with Steve, and we can certainly talk about this, is that I actually blame the rupture of relations between Russia and the U.S. on both sides. I agree with you that missile defense and NATO expansion was a no-no and definitely irritated the Russians. But just let me quote from Putin does this annual call-in conference. He was on the phone for, TV for 4.5 hours, calling in from Russian citizens. And about the bombings in Boston, he said, but the problem is not nationality, absolutely, or in religion. We already have said that many times. The problem is the extremist sentiments of these people. They arrived in the United States. They were given citizenship. The younger brother was a U.S. citizen. And what have they decided now? They've gone so far, not the U.S. leadership, but some U.S. politicians, as to speak of declaring the surviving criminal a prisoner of war. They are totally nuts. Now, this is Vladimir Putin talking about the U.S. government, or at least U.S. politics. So the question is, what do we do now? We kind of have our hands full. We're concerned about Syria. We're getting out of Afghanistan. Iraq is crumbling. So I'm not sure that it's on sort of on our plate to get involved in any way, shape, or form in the North Caucasus. And the other piece of it is that Putin is very jealous of Russian sovereignty, and I don't think he would be very happy if we want to build better relationship if we ever got actively involved there. So I think the way forward probably is intelligence sharing and trying to figure this out. Thank you.
Thank you for having me here. At the moment, Chechen president and Russian officials have openly distanced themselves from Tsarnaev's brothers, claiming that the Tsarnaevs are America's homegrown terrorists. Partly this is understandable. The two brothers have lived and studied in America for a long time. But this debate is of little importance without understanding, deep understanding of a real situation in Chechnya and the broader Caucasus and Central Asian region. Therefore, I was invited to share my insights on this matter. But I made my focus more narrow, and I would like to share with you my answers to three key questions, which I think are very important to understand this case. First, number one, what makes young American Chechens adopt extremist views? Number two, does their connection to the Russian Caucasus and Central Asia influence their worldview? Number three, what triggers extremist American Chechens to turn to violence? I have two assumptions. First, that the Tsarnaevs became extremists under the influence of jihadist ideas, and that this extremist identity was one of their own choosing. However, and this is my second assumption, that Tsarnaevs' increasing addiction to jihadism was cunningly used by forces of whom the Tsarnaevs were not aware. I spent all these days after the event trying to understand the mindset of especially Tamerlan Tsarnaev and analyze all his traces in internet and close examination of his and their web activity on YouTube in Russian and in English, Twitter, the Russian Facebook clone ВКонтакте, and the websites of Chechen Mujahideens, Kavkaz Center, sites like Islam IU, and many others, which both brothers visited frequently, suggests that elder suspect in the years prior to Boston bombings desperately search for identity and meaning of life. And of course, searching for meaning and identity is a normal process for young men, young immigrants making their life in America. But the problem is that his inner search was hugely, in my view, affected by the struggle in his home country, Chechnya, jihadism in the Caucasus, and the global radical Islamic ideology. The long history of the Chechen resistance against Russian occupation, the violent deportation of Chechens by Stalin to Central Asia and to my home country, Kyrgyzstan, during World War II, and the recent wars and guerrilla warfare with Russia teach Chechens to sacrifice their lives and use violence with no hesitation for the common interests of their nation. This mindset, I think, puts many Chechens into a vicious circle of revenge. Probably the elder brother was gravitated by this circle of people and ideas and didn't look beyond it. Even in America, it was difficult for Tamerlan to escape from the ideological pressure of Chechen jihadists who sacrificed their lives for Chechen independence. His YouTube collection of songs by Chechen freedom fighters is some evidence of that. We also know about Tamerlan's increasing interest in Islam. Islam in Chechnya and Dagestan, in the course of the extremely brutal Chechen-Russian wars, which were increasingly influenced by Arab Muslim fighters, got seriously infected by Salafism and Wahhabism, two radical ideologies. I discovered that Tamerlan Tsarnaev embraced notions of identity that were based on two abstract jihadist perceptions. The first, life on earth is only a temporary shelter. And second, as such, devote your life to jihad. In the last 15 years, I have met many young men from post-Soviet Central Asia and Caucasus with this attitude to life. Young men who are drawn to conservative and extreme versions of Islam. Zealots of these strains believe that America is at war with Islam. Equally important, they blame not only the United States government, but also the people that elect it. This partly explains why they made the choice to attack innocent citizens. As America rebounds from this strategy, I hope that cooperation with Russia on the matter of Islamic terrorism will be more transparent and balanced. There are no illusions, in my view, are made about the questionable policy of Vladimir Putin toward Chechnya. Russia uses state terror and the tyrannical rule of the president of Chechnya, Ramzan Kadyrov, to deter jihadists in Chechnya and the Caucasus. I know many evidences how Russian governments has been used Chechen extremists for their own political purposes and against their opponents abroad. This kind of controversial policy, in my view, escalates tensions, perpetuates the cycle of violence, and provides moral support for jihad. The United States and Russia cooperation on this matter should be interesting from a historical perspective. During the Cold War, you know, both countries created and directed various terrorist organizations. But can we be sure today that such Cold War stratagems are a things of the past? I spent 15 years in relation with the military and security of countries such as Russia, China, Afghanistan, Pakistan, and of course, all former Soviet republics. As a member of parliament, initiated investigation of drug trafficking from Afghanistan and through Central Asia to Russia and Europe. Was representative of my country to the Organization for Security and Cooperation in Europe. And of course, we discuss a lot the problem of terrorism and extremism in Central Asia and Caucasus, and spent years in working with the staff of Organization for Islamic Conference in Cairo. And of course, one of the main priorities of this organization was terrorism. And they spent 5 years in South Asia visiting Afghanistan and Pakistan and trying to understand the causes of this terrorism and drug trafficking. I'm telling about that because due to a time limit, if you want to ask more, I can share with you more information, which is really very much connected to this case. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much for the to the Center for National Studies for having me here. It's nice to be back, although obviously I wish the circumstances were a bit better. But I study political violence, so you kind of live every day kind of hoping to be put out of business, and unfortunately reality doesn't let that happen. So I'm coming at this from a bit of a different perspective than some of the great speakers beforehand who have talked about the historical context, the geographical context of Chechnya. My background, the classes that I teach on, the research I do, is on political violence and terrorism. Why individuals and groups commit violence, what the effectiveness of that violence is, what are some of the dynamics and strategies that groups use to do this type of stuff. And so I'll try to provide a little insight on the Boston Marathon bombings in that regard. The first point is some of you guys have probably heard about a lot in the news, this idea of lone wolves, the extent to which the individuals who committed this attack, are they connected to an organization? Were they lone wolves, people who we generally refer to as, you know, self-starters, perhaps self-radicalizers, individuals who decided to commit these attacks but not at the behest or perhaps with any training from an armed organization? A couple things on that. There's some good news and there's some bad news from the perspective of peace-loving citizens here in this room, which I assume most of us are. The first is that the bad news for lone wolves is that obviously as we think about, they're very hard to identify, they have easy access to soft targets, and perhaps most importantly, they can turn us against each other. We can start to worry that our neighbor or someone near us is someone who might try to kill us or commit a bombing for a political end. And so in that sense, lone wolves are kind of a scary thing. They're not necessarily someone who's easy to identify and again can lead to false identification, which can be a much bigger problem than even the bombing itself can be. On the good news end, the number of people who are actually killed or targeted in lone wolf attacks each year in the United States is under 100. If you compare that to the 35,000 Americans who die each year in car accidents, or even the 55 or so who die each year in lightning strikes, it's actually quite a small number in terms of the number of people who have been killed by lone wolf attacks. So for the most part, the people who have launched these attacks are actually phenomenally incapable. There's actually a couple of articles out there in the mainstream media and in scholarly work that says basically the case for calling them idiots or morons, in the sense that they oftentimes can't build bombs, they can't build a detonator. Even guys like Faisal Shahzad, who tried to blow up in Times Square a few years ago, had some training in Waziristan, was unable to set off a successful attack. And so most of the time, these people, even if they're dreamers who want to commit these big attacks, are usually not very successful at doing so. In that sense, these two brothers here, to the extent that they committed these bombings, and it seems that there's overwhelming evidence that they did, they're actually the anomaly as opposed to the rule in terms of people who are actually able to build bombs that killed individuals and perhaps had some type of impact. In terms of talking about this, though, going forward, and today we just saw news about three new arrests, perhaps related to these bombings. Again, it's unclear to the extent to which they're lone wolves. I might actually introduce a term which I haven't seen anywhere, but maybe it'll catch on. They're kind of more like perhaps gray wolves in the sense that they're not lone in the sense that they just did this all on their own. It's possible the older brother had training, either when he was over in Russia, or perhaps there's a lot of talk about these guys maybe read the Al-Qaeda English language online magazine Inspire, which has this incredibly kind of humorous titled article, How to Build a Bomb in the Kitchen of Your Mom. If you speak Arabic, you recognize that that's just kind of a bad English translation. But the basic idea was, here's how you can build a bomb using pressure cookers or other types of things you can buy in a basic hardware or cooking store. And there's some thought that maybe that was how these individuals learned about how to build this. Although in recent days, there's been more intel from FBI sources saying that perhaps they had some training because of specific aspects of how they built the bomb. Nonetheless, long and short of it, lone wolves, a very scary proposition. In one sense, at least to this day, in terms of the number of people who have actually been killed, not nearly as terrible as we might think. Now, second point, and this actually goes to the religious point that Steve and a couple of others have brought up,
And I think these are both really important points, but you rarely hear them in the same place, and I think it's worth saying them even though that they might sound somewhat familiar in different form. The first is that the vast majority of Muslims in this country are peaceful and very proud Americans. And if you think about what's happened after these attacks, beyond just looking into religion as being a source of the bombing, and I think that that's a potential thing to look at, and we'll talk about that in a second, it's also important to note that there were a number of hate crimes that happened here in our community, people who assaulted this woman who's a Palestinian doctor who lives in the area. And these are the types of things that I think as a community, first in terms of American values, we need to speak out against. But additionally, we need to think about, even if, you know, for some reason you don't like people who are of a certain religion, when you think about why these attacks actually get prevented, a lot of it has to do with the fact that the community speaks out against this type of violence or drops dimes on individuals who are doing these types of things or planning these types of things. So going forward, thinking about having a community that has a stake in the United States or elsewhere is very, very important at integrating individuals who are refugees or immigrants, even if your sole goal is to try to prevent attacks like this. So on the one hand, I think that's a key point regarding religion. On the other end of things, the people who often talk in that regard don't talk about the fact or like to hide the fact, perhaps, that religion played a role here. And you have to look at how people are claiming attacks or what they're saying their motivations were, but I think there's mounting evidence that religion, at least as these individuals portray it, did play a role here. And so in that sense, even though many of us in this room might say, well, Al-Qaeda is not following true Islam, or the Lord's Resistance Army in Africa is not following true Christianity, even though they claim Christian roots is for their attacks, I don't think it's something that we should just ignore and put our heads in the sand about. I think that we need to engage with this, even if our ultimate objective or strategy is not, well, the United States should be getting involved in debates about Islam, which Steve eloquently talked about, and that's something that we can discuss more in the Q&A. All right, now in terms of some of the things that I actually, you know, feel like I study and have a little bit to say, one is the effectiveness of terrorism or political violence. What do attacks like this actually achieve? I think one of the first things you can think about it in terms of three different levels of analysis. You've got tactical effectiveness, organizational effectiveness, and strategic effectiveness. Actually, I should kind of do those up the line because they're higher levels of abstraction. Tactical effectiveness is simply being able to carry out a bombing, being able to actually, you know, detonate a bomb, perhaps kill some people. And as I say, the vast majority of attacks that are thought about in the United States never even reach this level. A lot of these individuals are captured in FBI stings or otherwise unable to even have tactically effective attacks. But beyond that, it's actually even much more difficult to have organizational or strategically effective violence. Organizationally effective violence is violence that actually gains recruit or popular support for an organization. Strategically effective violence is violence that actually gets concessions from a target government. So in the case of Al-Qaeda, it could be United States withdrawal from the Middle East. In the case of these individuals, again, there hasn't been claiming, but they perhaps want the United States to also remove itself from the Middle East or perhaps not support the Russians in Chechnya, though again, we're not really doing that in any case. But for the most part, most terrorist attacks or political violence attacks are actually phenomenally unsuccessful in terms of their strategic impact. So it's important to think about that, not just to get some perspective, but also to understand that we as a community actually hold the key in terms of strategic effectiveness for this use of violence. We get to decide whether at the end of the day we're going to make concessions, we're going to change the way our society operates, or not. They have the ability to potentially kill people, but if we're going to make an outsized difference politically in terms of what the impact of their attack is, that's going to come down to our political leaders and us as citizens making that distinction and making that determination. Whether that's empowering or not, it's an important thing to understand. Now, going forward and thinking about the idea of the response, another key point is just thinking about whether we overreacted, underreacted, or had the right reaction to these attacks. After the lockdown that we all experienced in various forms, whether you lived close by over here in Cambridge or just down the road or you lived across the river, it seemed after the fact that there were a lot of people on the streets cheering and supporting the police and the FBI who had been involved in this operation. And I will say historically, capturing the individuals who seemed like they committed this attack that quickly is quite a phenomenal thing. That's pretty rare to have that happen so quickly. And so I think in that sense, the law enforcement should be commended. On the other hand of things, it's important to understand the fact that this is an operation that costs hundreds of millions of dollars. It perhaps set a precedent going forward that we're going to shut down a major city when an attack like this happens. And some people have raised the question of, well, if you're a guy with a couple of pressure cooker bombs, do you decide to attack Boston or attack somewhere else like this, knowing that you can get this type of response? Is this something that's just a one-time deal, or is this something that we're prepared to do again and again? And is, in that sense, the fact that we're acting in a fearful way something that gives these individuals who are able to put or willing to put bombs at the feet of small children more than they're actually worth or more of a response than they should actually get? I think these are important questions to talk about. And obviously, in the days after an attack, a lot of us are kind of still in a grieving phase. We're thinking about the people who are still in the hospital having lost limbs. We're thinking about the families who have lost loved ones, people in the MIT community who knew the police officer who was, you know, cowardly way gunned down. But nonetheless, it's important to think about how do we actually want to respond to this stuff? Because this has precedent not just for treating people like enemy combatants or not, but also in terms of, as a society, how are we going to deal with this when attacks like this happen again, as unfortunately they inevitably probably will. In Boston, it's not like living in London. We're not taped publicly every day when we're on the streets with cameras, et cetera, but that's changing. In the T's, when you're in the subway stations, that's happening more and more. I guarantee you that's going to happen more and more on the streets of Boston. We need to think about as a society if that's something we want to do. What about domestic drones? What about reading emails? Are these types of things that we think are too big of an infringement on our civil liberties, or are these infringements that we're willing to deal with to be more safe? Important things to think about. I'm still on the MIT network for texts that come on what's going on the campus, and I'll tell you, if you guys are as well, I've been getting seemingly two or three texts a day about suspicious packages on campus. Now, in the one sense, that's great because I would like to have transparency about what's going on. I know that MIT has security officers that are here taking care of us, and that's a great thing. On the other end of things, if that's happening every day, is that kind of making us more fearful than we otherwise should be about something that's actually a pretty low likelihood event? Again, these are things that we don't necessarily talk about all the time because politically it's very difficult to bring this up, but it's nonetheless something that I think we need to debate if we want to talk about the effectiveness of these attacks and how we're going to respond to them as a society. In terms of overall, what my takeaway point from this will be is simply that I'm not going to counsel one way or the other in terms of over or under reaction, unless you want to talk about it more in the Q&A, but I will say this. I'm incredibly confident that having more knowledge about when and why these things happen, how they're actually effective or not, and what we can do about them is going to lead to better answers as a society and how we deal with terrorism and counterterrorism going forward. So in that sense, I'm actually quite encouraged by the people who are here today, getting both historical context, as we have from the speakers before, as well as understanding the broader context of individuals and groups who have committed violence like this before, knowing both what it can achieve, what it cannot achieve, and what, at the end of the day, we get to decide in terms of whether it will have a broader significant political impact or not. Thank you very much.
Hello. I'd like to thank the organizers for getting us all together. These are wonderful educational opportunities, I think, for all of us here, but certainly for the community at large. What I'm going to talk about is a little bit concerning the legal framework for what has happened. You might have noticed that on April 21, the FBI issued or appealed for a complaint against Dzhokhar Tsarnaev under what's called Title 18, which is the federal code Title 18. And you might have been a little bit surprised to learn that it was with relevance to the use of a weapon of mass destruction. So the first thing I'm going to talk about is why is that. Why are we into the realm of weapon of mass destruction? Is that how we usually think? The second thing I'm going to talk about is the FBI and its changing structure after 9/11. The FBI that we have today, in terms of its emphasis on intelligence as opposed to criminal investigation, and also the level of science that you find. Forensics in general, is really, really different from if you go back to, for example, just the year 2000. And also there's been a change in the training and emphasis of special agents and people who are intelligence analysts. So that's one part. Those are two parts. And then the third part I'd like to talk about is profiling and what the FBI has done with profiling and why they ever do it and how far you can get with it. And I should say here that my background is really the study of the 2001 anthrax letter attacks, which is how I learned over the course of about 8 years what the FBI does, because I didn't really understand until I became involved with the anthrax letter attacks as a research subject what this big institution does. So let me start with Title 18. Why Title 18? Title 18 is part of the federal code for criminal violations. And although we, since about 1947, have used weapons of mass destruction to refer to particularly biological and chemical weapons, and also nuclear weapons. We entered a new phase in terms of the code around the year 2000, I think was a real turning point, with the bombing of the USS Cole over in Yemen. And then, even more of a turning point, with the Timothy McVeigh bombing of the building in Oklahoma City. Both of those events were for the Department of Justice and for the FBI, and I think for the government in general, US government in general, very important, because what they showed was that you could have a mass effect on US soldiers, US Navy, and then you could have a mass effect on these people who were working in a government building. And that is the point at which you begin to see what we would call now fairly radical revisions in terms of the federal code. So mass attack, right? You can go back, by the way, into the 80s, you can see these changes happening. But mass attack is now written into Title 18 for the use of explosives. So it's very specific. It says biological weapons, the use of biological weapons. It says the use of chemical weapons. And then it doesn't say the use of nuclear weapons, by the way. It says because we have a particular approach to nuclear weapons, so it does not refer to the use of nuclear weapons as a crime, because we don't believe that. We have not ascribed to that particularly. But it does refer to the release of radiation or radioactivity at a level dangerous to human life. So that's the phrasing out of the code. Now, you might have seen in the complaint that the FBI issued that it refers also to a section 844I. And what it is referring to here is very specifically the destruction of property to the point of death. So you have actually two features in the complaint. One of them is the use of a bomb, so that it causes mass casualties. And the other one is this use of a weapon, in this case a bomb, which causes property damage to property to the point of death. So you can have the death and the property thing together. The person who would be brought to court, brought to trial under this complaint, could be charged with both. And it looks from the complaint as it stands now that Tsarnaev would be charged with both. What's interesting here is the first one is a life imprisonment or death penalty level, right, of accusation of prosecution. The property damage is not, all right? So you'll have two different features probably running through the trial. Interesting here, if the defendant pleads guilty to either of those, the issue of the death penalty disappears, and it goes down to life imprisonment, because that's required, because there were deaths. But for the property damage one, it becomes a certain number of years. So it's interesting. It's not as simple a case, actually, as it looks right now, or as you might think. There is in Title 18 what we all know, because from watching CSI or watching any reading detective novels, anything, there is murder in the first degree, and then there is second degree murder. Everything else is second degree. But murder in the first degree under Title 18 is characterized as in conventional law in the United States, malice aforethought, with a murder or perpetrated with malice aforethought. That is, there has to be planning in it. It has to be something that was, where there's evidence that it was not done in a spirit of passion or by impulse, that it's something that was actually planned out. And with that, it is either the death penalty or life imprisonment. Okay, so if it's murder one, as we say, under this Title 18, there is no 20 years in jail or 40 years in jail or anything like that. It really is life imprisonment or it is the death penalty. The death penalty can only be the judgment if the Attorney General of the United States says that the death penalty will be pursued. And so Holder has the option to say, wherever this trial would take place, just life imprisonment, not the death penalty. I don't think he's going to do that. But that is an option that the Attorney General has. So the Attorney General has that option, but it is up to the local jury, wherever the trial takes place. The local jury is actually takes the role of the decision maker. So the local jury, where will the local jury be? And I think we all understand it has to be in a place where the where the members of that jury are not familiar with anyone, do not know anyone who was harmed in this event. So that's going to be tricky because people came from all over Massachusetts. So there may be a question of, will this trial be taken away? Will it go someplace else? So these are some of the complexities that will come up. And this is all out of Title 18. Now, let me just go very quickly to what the FBI has become since 9/11. And this has already been alluded to. How good is our intelligence? Well, you might remember that after 9/11, President Bush was on television blaming the FBI because, in fact, the Al-Qaeda perpetrators had attacked the Twin Towers. Now, 4 days before 9/11, the present director of the FBI, Robert Mueller, was actually sworn into office by that same president. So Robert Mueller comes in. He's new. It wasn't on his watch, right? But he has become, over the years, a person whose main idea is to turn the FBI into a counterterrorism organization, which also has increased enormously and will keep increasing enormously its capacity to do intelligence work. Now, why is that even interesting? Well, that's interesting because the history of the FBI is the history of agents who do criminal investigations. That's what it was there for. And that's a very different mission. To do a criminal investigation, you have something terrible happens, then you send out your special agents into the field. They begin the process of interviewing witnesses. They begin the process of forensics. They begin building the basis for trial-worthy evidence. Very important. You have to think always as a investigator out in the field that everything you're doing is building towards that time when the prosecution is there in court, the prosecutor is there, and they are making the case against that defendant. That's the main intent, right, that people in the FBI for generations have been educated to as their expertise and as their mission. Intelligence is very different, as I think we all understand. Intelligence is a long range and much more highly secret, by the way, endeavor, which is supposed to let you know sources of information in very disparate parts of the world or within crime networks. So can the FBI do intelligence? Absolutely. In fact, that has been the main transition. There have been structural changes within the FBI which have enhanced the intelligence component. The FBI and the CIA meet together now under the general umbrella of federal intelligence. The training of agents, even field agents, into the methods of intelligence has increased. The numbers of intelligence analysts has doubled since 9/11. And the whole momentum, if you look at it now, and even the list of priorities that the FBI issues, puts intelligence and counterterrorism very high up. And of course, there are over 70 overseas offices or postings for FBI agents, so they're working all the time overseas. Have they worked well enough overseas to prevent what happened on April 15th? Well, of course not. Of course not. Not a perfect organization, but an organization that has really dramatically changed. Now, just very quickly, let me just say a few things about profiling. There have been other instances that look like this particular event in terms of the perpetrators. And you might remember the Beltway snipers, all right? So you had a Mohammed and Malcolm were the two the perpetrators, and they eventually come to trial, and one of them, it's the older man and the younger man, by the way, they have figured out a system of attack, you know, out of the back of a car, which a random attack on white people, by the way, But if you looked into their emails and their other communications, you find that jihadist rhetoric was very, very strong. It was all in the list of, for example, what the prosecution presented. It was amazing how much the rhetoric there was and how much passion there was invested in the notion of a jihad against Americans and a jihad particularly against whites, right? So that's an analogous case. That comes down to a Folie à Deux case. It's a case of, it's not a lone wolf, there are two. And so then what are the larger ramifications of that? Is that really the good analogy that we want? Well, profiling is very tricky business. It starts in the FBI in the 1980s as a real profession, if you will, within the FBI because of rape cases. They decided in the 1980s that if there was an unidentified rapist, maybe they could track a rapist by profiling and then using the profile as a way of identifying people who maybe knew the victim. So that's the sort of the beginning of profiling. It's way, way beyond that now. It's very sophisticated. And in the case of Bruce Ivins, who was the prime suspect in the anthrax letter attacks, the profiling was at a level that was really very hard to have even imagined 10 or 15 or 20 years before. And this happened in part because he was a employee of the Department of Defense, and he had signed a statement before he committed suicide in 2008 that let his mental health records, everything he had ever had in terms of therapy sessions or drugs he had taken or anything that he had done in terms of mental health, would be open for government perusal. Now, they didn't look at any of those records while he was alive and while he was a suspect. But after the fact, there is now an entire book which profiles this man, Bruce Ivins, in incredible detail. And what's interesting to me is what you find with him and what you seem to find as a pattern with all of the lone wolves, but also with group terrorists, are some of the things that Jessica Stern has mentioned, for example, when she's written about Islamic terrorists. A sense of inferiority, a sense of not being appreciated, alienation from the larger society, to the point of social rejection. All right, so that you look for that, maybe that would be in a profile. The other thing that you see is a impulsivity, a real disregard for risk, and that gets to be associated with young people. And we know this. I mean, you could go to the neuroscience here, but the human brain, you know, up until about the age of 27, is really engineered, if you will, to take risks because this is a great learning time. After about age 27, the risk taking goes down, but 19 is really 18, 19, 20, 21. These are ages when people, our kids, are taking risks, all right? So impulsivity, ignorance of consequences, or not caring about consequences. And then there's something else, and this is very interesting to me because although there's enormous amount of work being done on the brain, the amygdala, impulsivity, depression, all of these things, we're beginning to understand these things so much better. But when I was writing about Bruce Ivins, I went back to William James, philosopher William James, who wrote a wonderful essay many, many years ago called The Divided Self. And in that essay, he talks about the tension in modern life between an interior life where you know who you are, you know you're flawed, and you know that you don't meet the expectations of other people, and the ideal you, that other you that should be out there, who should maybe be famous or should be totally virtuous or should be saint-like, that other person you know you're not, but you want to be, but you can't be. And so I'm going to end here by reading this sentence from William James. And he's referring to somebody who has this dilemma. And he says, "The man's interior is a battleground for what he feels to be two deadly hostile selves, one actual, the other ideal. And this is something which intrigues me about these both of these brothers. But I can assure you that you find it as a pattern through most of the other cases that I know of, where you see this mass murders, right? These are mass murders. And who perpetrates them. I just want to end on one thing, by the way. When we talk about how unusual the quick solution of this case was, and how we're all very grateful to the people in the FBI and the police force and everyone who came forward and helped, I think that's true. But look at the story again. Every bit of crucial information, from the identification of both brothers, initially by the one victim who lost his legs, that's the beginning part, to the man who was captured by them for 90 minutes in the van and then escaped, right? Absolutely crucial. To all the people who took the footage, to the surveillance camera. That was not FBI work, and that was not police work. That was what we call, you know, collective intelligence. That was the public. And that, I thought, was absolutely splendid. And I think without all of that participation, you really would not have had this case come to a climax or at least have the suspects in hand as quickly. So I'm very appreciative to everything law enforcement did. But the public in this case was, to my mind, the big difference. Thank you.
Okay, so I am... an immigration integration expert, if you want to say. And I'm actually going to talk about how it is that these two individuals had such divergent trajectories, even though they were brothers and came to the United States at the same time. A lot of the details that are here have been reported already, and you probably know a lot of this. But when you put them together, I think they provide a framework for understanding some of this. I'm interested in explaining how it is that these two brothers from the same origins had such very different experiences in terms of enculturation in the United States, and how did their trajectories eventually converge to create this sense of mass destruction. I was really happy to hear Professor Beshimov's presentation, because I think he talked a bit about this, which I think I'm happy to see. So I think that this framework really is something that brings together the brothers' age and psychological development at the time of arrival in the United States, also their previous experiences in the country of origin, their refugee status and reception in the United States. And these factors together provide clues into their varying levels of incorporation. I was reacting really to a lack of understanding that at the very beginning of the communications and news about these events that really looked at these bombers as immigrants, when in reality they're involuntary immigrants in this country, they're refugees, and I think that that's an important component of this situation. Both Yahar and Tamerlan came to the United States. Yahar was 8 years old and Tamerlan was 15. Both of them got involved in sports. They attended the mosque on Prospect Street here in Cambridge. They enrolled in Cambridge French and Latin. Some people would go as far as to say that Cambridge French and Latin is one of the most culturally accepting environments for higher learning. In this context, Jahor really thrived. He immigrated at a young age. He went to school with the same kids he was growing up with. He ended up having the same friends through all his school. He gradually lost his accent and became a well-liked and respected student. That's what we know so far. On the other hand, Tamerlan immigrated as a teenager, and I think we really need to recognize that immigrating as a teenager, as an adolescent, is really the most difficult time for anybody to immigrate, okay? And this is important because he was 15 at the time. He became an excellent boxer but never lost his accent, and his English was hard to understand. This opened him to discrimination. Anybody who has an accent in this country, unless you're weirdly well-known and you are some type of personality, is discriminated against with an accent. We already know this, but refugees come from areas where conflict is historically embedded and marked in ideology and injustice. refugees may suffer from what I call a refugees deficit. And what I mean by that is basically understanding that you have escaped something that others have not been able to escape, and that that puts you in a deficit when it comes to the relationship you have with others that stayed behind. This is really important if you were an adolescent, at least an adolescent or a young adult, all the way to young adulthood, because then you integrated some of this information. So while Yahar was only a child during the war, Tamerlan experienced that civil conflict as an adolescent, shaping his identity as part of that conflict. It's very hard. We heard a lot of information about how this was very prevalent. So this was all of this historical injustice was very much alive as an adolescent coming to the United States. Once in the United States, Tamerlan could not find kinship with American youth. For most refugees, American youth seem to be extremely naive because they just don't have any kind of concept about this kind of conflict. This is not something that he could find very easy kinship in terms of talking to people about. This really kind of makes his networks be very selective when it comes to other people who have a similar background. And that also predisposes to particular trajectories. He did not, as he reported, he didn't understand Americans and he had no friends. Also, it's reported that Americans often assumed that they were Russian. So if you're coming from Chechnya and people are calling you, oh, are you Russian? You know, for Yahar, this was probably like a curious motivating force. You know, maybe I want to find out more about this. But for Tamerlan, that's, you can probably think that this was cumulative microaggressions. You know, how many times do you have to tell people, no, I'm not Russian, I'm actually Chechen, when that is like so filled with a sense of injustice? As hopefully everybody knows, refugee status provides a legal path to citizenship. All of the immigration rhetoric right now in terms of the policies that we're considering all have to do with the undocumented immigrants. So they're the ones that don't have a path to citizenship. But refugees do. They go through a period of time when they are the refugee status, then they become permanent residents, then they have access to American citizenship. As Yahar got older, he continued his acculturation in Cambridge and attained American citizenship. On the other hand, Tamerlan was arrested for domestic violence. This was later dismissed. Nevertheless, this curtailed his application for US citizenship. Now, this appeared in the New York Times, I think, 2 days ago, but Tamerlan was also a very good boxer. And it wasn't until he had captured his second consecutive title as the Golden Gloves heavyweight champion of New England that he was barred from the national tournament of champions because he was not a United States citizen. So these were the opponents, trainers basically, were so upset with him because he was winning so much that they basically mobilized the association to take into consideration this rule that they had in the books but not really applying it so that it be applied against him and get him off of the boxing possibilities. That's a big blow. I mean, if you think in terms of somebody who's really wanting to be a boxer, who's really wanting to, that's what his dream is about. If suddenly the country that you're trying, that you're being integrated into decides that you're not American enough to be a champion boxer, these things are all what I call microaggressions. So we can think that the precipitants for this have to do with the fact that he was basically barred from the Golden Gloves. The Golden Gloves is like one step before Olympics. I mean, these are very high status boxers. He intensifies his relationship to Islam, goes to Russia. His family did not agree with the radicalization and actions, landed the attention of the Russian government and the FBI that didn't mobilize on this. I think it's very important to realize that the parents moved back to Russia in 2011. This left the young son alone, okay, with this radicalizing brother. And he really admired this brother. So that left the younger son in a very vulnerable position. And this is how their different trajectories converged while Tamerlan died in the confrontation. He left the younger brother alone to face the consequences. So what do we have for recommendations? I think we need to develop policies specifically directed at refugees who have the migratory transition in the midst of their adolescence. This has implications for their identity development. And this is, you know, there are the refugee population, I don't know exactly how many there are, but it is something that's doable. I mean, if you just look at the adolescents in that population, I think we could do a lot just with that, by paying attention to that particular population. We need to provide psychological services that include exposure to pro-social networks, offering opportunities for support and leverage that will lead towards integration, not isolation. And I truly believe that failure to act in this preventive way will continue to have, like, young people who come from places where there are very strong senses of historically embedded injustices, who then are very easy prey to a narrative like the narrative of Al-Qaeda. It's just very easy to make this jump when you have been brought up in that kind, with that particular background. And you have this deficit, this refugee deficit that really kind of makes you want to fight, even though you're not able to. So this is I think, a very complicated factor that will really help if we pay attention to refugee immigrant children who come here as adolescents. So that's it. I want to put this back.
Thanks very much, Silvia, and thanks to you all for being very patient. The microphones are open, and what we'll do is ask you to identify yourself. Please come to the mics. There's one on each side. And please direct your question at individual speakers, or if you would like anyone to sort of take up the challenge, that's fine, too. We'll start over here. Yes, sir. Please identify yourself.
Okay. My name is Marti Vallila, is the... my name is pronounced in my former country. I'm a refugee here, actually, or an immigrant. So one of the questions I have is this term refugee deficit. I find a little bit strange. I'd learned English when I came here. English was the fifth language I had to learn, but I learned it. So I'm not sure about this refugee deficit idea. The specific question I have for you is, you made a statement, I'm speaking to the last speaker there, yes. You said that everyone who speaks with an accent here in the United States is, what was your term? Yes, is discriminated against.
Well, let's just say that having an accent opens up the possibility of you being discriminated.
Opens up the possibility of you being. Can you give one example that of someone with an accent where they're discriminated against?
This happens every day. I mean, I've been discriminated against for having an accent.
You have?
Yeah. I mean, I think.
Give me an instance.
Just in terms of what people perceive, and what kind of. Stereotype that may place you, or
no? Give me an example of you. You're saying you're in your life, you have an accent.
Yeah. Well, okay. I think that so people have treated me differently once they have heard me speak in certain situations.
Give me an example.
Please. You've asked the question. The professor has responded. If you're not satisfied, I apologize on all of our behalves for that. But let's go to the next question here.
First, thanks for a fantastically interesting panel.
Chris, would you identify yourself?
Across the board. My name is Christopher Leiden. I'm a blogger and journalist across the board in many media. I just wanted to note this. The New Yorker popped into my box today has a very interesting piece by Steve Cole, who has forgotten more about, you know, the Afghan wars than most of us will ever absorb. It's a post-Boston reconsideration of the drone wars. And of course, it does not connect the drone wars to Boston, but it raises questions, and I think Steve Cole is hoping and maybe expecting that the Boston Marathon bombing will sharpen and open an American conversation about the purposes and the effects of the drone war. But specifically addressing Professor Krause's fascinating question, I mean, it's really a profound question. What did they think that would accomplish? What was the hope or the purpose, if there was one, rational, irrational, or otherwise? I just throw it out there that what, as a non-fan of the drone war, maybe that's part of my bias, but what if the purpose of that they're thinking, again, rational, crazy, whatever, hateful, jihadist, whatever you, however we classify it, what if the purpose was to show us our own reaction to this kind of attack? And in a sense, to show us the ineffectiveness of our own counter-terrorist killings and signature strikes over there in the Islamic world? What is this to say? Like, how does this feel to you? And what, reconsider in the light of our anger, our outrage, our horror, our regret, et cetera, what the effects of this of vaguely comparable attacks are over there.
Peter, why don't you get started,
sure.
And others can pick it up.
This pick me up right in here, I guess. Better speak, yeah, speak loudly. I have no problem speaking loudly, as you guys saw before. I probably talked too loudly. So great question. So I'll say real quick, I mean, I don't know if you've seen, there are a couple polls about how Americans feel about drones. And it's very interesting. You know, the majority of Americans are supportive of using drone strikes abroad. But then the question comes to, what about drones on the U.S.-Mexican border or domestic drones? And then the number goes way down. So there definitely is kind of a disconnect there. But apparently, in terms of the technology and whether it's kind of for thee but not for me, or these types of questions that I think were the bombers thinking in that regard, there's a lot of, you know, kind of potential traction there they could be trying to expose or getting us to think about. But just as I'm, you know, even though I talked a lot about this stuff in kind of the context of political violence, and I'm still a little bit hesitant to say that this attack was necessarily political, I still don't think we 100% know that for sure. I definitely don't think that, I feel like there's enough evidence yet to say they were doing it for the motivations that you were saying. So while I do think, you know, from the classes that I teach, I've had a number of students who have raised questions along these lines and saying, well, you know, this is a tragedy. Some of them were running the marathon and were within a minute or two of where the bombings happened. But we talk a lot about intervention in Syria or places where, you know, 70 or 80,000 people have been killed. And so how do you compare those, or why do I care so much more about this one down the block than, you know, that one over there? And I think those are worthwhile questions to ask. I mean, I think at the same time, sometimes it gets a bit more extreme, and it's kind of like, you know, if your mother's ill and someone comes to you and says, well, 70 other,000 mothers are ill at the time. I mean, obviously you care about your mother. You have personal and family ties. You care about things in your community, like the officer was killed here. So I think to some degree that's understandable. That's being human. At the same time, I do think that there definitely is a disconnect. Some people here pointed to the fact that in America, thankfully to some degree, but nonetheless, we do live in a bit of a naive bubble about some political violence, don't face it the same way other societies necessarily do. So I think that whether that was the intention or not of the bombers, and I don't think there's enough evidence to yet say it was, I do think I have seen some of this reconsideration or thinking and connecting this to that broader context. And I'm not sure what the result of that conversation will be, but I do see this evidence of this.
Yeah, if I could comment.
Please,
also,
Jeanne.
The question I think you're asking is, are we looking at this in a political framework, or are we looking at it in terms of psychology? So I think it's very tough, because I think the examples we had before in previous years, we have Dr. Hassan at Fort Hood, you know, killing 13 people. You have, also with a jihadist background, if you will, or taking that framework. But you also have Timothy McVeigh, and people forget Timothy McVeigh was using fundamentalist Christian language in the months before he went out, you know, went and blew up the building. So, so I think it's really difficult. There can be political metaphors, but when you have just two people or one person, are you really looking at some great political message, or are you looking at someone looking, seeking the exhilaration of violence, the exhilaration of violence, of doing something mortally terrible and enjoying it, see, and wanting it? And I think that that looks like more of a driver in this particular case than even 9/11, by the way.
Certainly. Others on the panel? Okay, sir?
Hi, I'm David Williams. I'm a student here. I haven't been following it completely that much. You can correct me if my information's wrong, but one of the disconnects I find in hearing the news is, you know, there's the bombings, and then there's a lot of behind-the-scenes work being done by the police, and then there's sort of this disconnect till Thursday night when Sean was killed. And, you know, the question that has not been answered to me is, why did they shoot him? And so was that, so the idea is, I know they're not, they're terrorists, so they're not exactly the most logical people, but, you know, if you're, they made a clean getaway, so why did they just go and assassinate this someone? So really, a lot of proof says that, you know, their videos were out, they were being looked for. So my basically what I'm getting at is, it seems, though, that the FBI, the police, by releasing the photos, sort of put pressure on them to cause these murders. You know, they're walking down the street, they bump into Sean, they see a police officer, they think they've been recognized, and then, you know, all of a sudden they're throwing grenades. Like, it doesn't sort of make any sense. And I was wondering if you guys, what you thought about whether releasing their photos was the appropriate thing to do. Because not only did it encourage them to lash out, but it also could release, you know, false identifications and, you know, other sorts of issues of vigilantism and stuff like that.
Thank you. Jeanne, that sounds like it's for you or Peter.
You go back to the Unabomber case. Remember the Unabomber? They went through all of this issue about should we release his letters, his political tracts, and put them in the Washington Post and Times, and was this a good thing? And it turned out it was a good thing because, in fact, his Ted Kaczynski's sister-in-law and then the brother recognized the language, and it actually solved the case. So that set a precedent for how much do we ask of the public. In the Bruce Ivins case, in the anthrax letter case, before they even think about Bruce Ivins, the FBI worked with the American Society for Microbiology and sent out messages to 250,000 members of the American Society for Microbiology, asking them if they had a colleague they thought was a little odd or might fit the profile of someone with hidden anger. And I can tell you they did get answers. You can imagine the answers that came back, right? And one of the answers that came back was a woman who had known Bruce Ivins and had been a graduate student when he was a graduate student. And interestingly enough, the FBI interviewed her out in Oregon. Two guys went out, just like here. The local people came out and interviewed this person, and they dropped it. They didn't think it was important, so they wrote a little report, but they couldn't believe that a man who worked at Fort Detrick, right after 9/11, could ever be the suspect. So because of this question of how much do we ask the public to participate, and I know, personally, I know that the people here in Boston, the field officers here, gave it a lot of thought. It wasn't something that they wanted to do, but there is this idea. And I think you've expressed it very, very well, that you could be enlisting the public in identification, but you could also be influencing what is going on that could be very negative. So I know they went back and forth on it, but, you know, in this particular case, it was the better idea. But I think the negative, the downside of it, absolutely right. Right.
A couple quick points. That was a great question. So a couple of things. Just on the rationality point, because you brought that up, I think it's a really tough thing for us to get our minds around sometime because these are individuals who it seems like, you know, put bombs in backpacks and then put them down at the feet of an 8-year-old child and looked at that child's eyes maybe and then walked away knowing that they were going to kill that individual. So in one sense, you think, how could that person be mentally stable? How, you know, that's a mentally ill thing to do. On the other end of things, very, very small percentage of people who commit terrorist acts are actually diagnosed as mentally ill before or after. factor. So even though we might have a hard time thinking how someone could kill another individual like that, in terms of kind of diagnosed before or after with having mental illness, it's actually quite a small percentage. That's maybe scary to think about, but that's kind of one point. In terms of the stories about why they killed Sean, some of the things I've seen is that they wanted to get his gun, and they were unable to do so because it had kind of like a multiple locks into it, so they wanted to kind of up the ante in terms of the weapons they had, which is interesting. They had a number of bombs, but not that many guns. Again, getting to the fact that on the one hand, these guys were anomalous in the sense that they were able to build a bomb that worked. On the other hand, they were kind of like Keystone Cops afterwards in terms of not having any idea what their getaway plan was, what the next step was, even though they had these other bombs. So in that sense, they weren't necessarily prepared. In terms of releasing the photos, I agree with Jeanne. I think it was the right thing to do, but I think you're also correct to note, and Jeanne was correct to note, you know, the public played a huge role here. They were the ones, you know, like the lockdown seemingly made a difference, but then the best intel came right after they lifted it, right? So that's key. But then it's also important to note that the public did some of the worst things here, right? Like if you follow Reddit or some of these other things that I know a lot of people, you know, take as, you know, not necessarily the Bible, but something they really think is a great thing, they falsely identified a number of people and kind of, you know, necessarily ruined their lives, but did a lot of bad things by saying, oh, is this the bomber? New York Post did that. So the public is both kind of the greatest asset and resource, and I think one of the reasons the FBI released these photos because they needed their help, but also, you know, a real danger there. So I think at the end of the day, they made the right choice, but you're right to raise the fact that it's a dangerous game for sure.
Anyone else? Sir.
Well, reports in the European press and elsewhere have actually said that the younger brother, after he was captured and was asked what the motive was, stated that it was very clearly and explicitly, perhaps the only question that he answered, was that it was Iraq and Afghanistan. So it's grimly, morbidly, even kind of ironic that on the same day as the Marathon atrocity, there was a bombing in Iraq that killed 27 people. In the month of April alone, 561 civilians have been killed by terrorist attacks in Iraq, and we started off May today with 15 more. And as has been mentioned before, we don't seem to have the same remorse or outpouring of grieving, even though we're directly responsible for that train of events, not to mention the thousands and thousands that were killed by the wars and the genocidal sanctions. So I'm wondering why, and if we can blunt some of this anger, if we have war crimes tribunals, and if we have people responsible for torture and other acts of crimes against humanity, even though they may be some of our own officials.
Steve, it sounds like for you.
To me, the best insight into the motives behind the attack is the YouTube account that Tamerlan Tsarnaev maintained. And there he seems to link to, he posts a couple of videos, one of which is a standard Al-Qaeda video. It's got a twist on it. The preacher is a fellow I've never heard of before, but he's an Australian. I think his name was Reed. Does anyone remember the guy's name? Can't recall. And the narrative involves a place in Central Asia, Khorasan, which actually was an ancient political entity, and how the people of Khorasan are some getting to sweep through the Middle East and solve all the problems and bring about the end times. So to me, I'm not so sure that Afghanistan and Iraq are the only piece of the puzzle. They're part of the narrative, but I think that they were animated by this larger narrative, which is pretty much universal throughout sort of Al-Qaeda land, and it takes the same form. And the complaints extend way beyond Afghanistan and Iraq to a general war of civilizations. It's a victim narrative about war of civilizations. And so I think you have to address this larger narrative. And it's a great question, you know, if the United States, this is a research question, key question, what if the U.S. withdrew from the world? Would Al-Qaeda, if you will, follow at home? And scholars all disagree on that. Bob Pape has written a terrific book on suicide bombing, arguing essentially that you see very rarely see it emanating from places that aren't in some way suffering actual occupation. And the other view is more of a narrativist view, that people have big imaginations and can direct their anger even at people who are very remotely connected to the suffering they're actually feeling if they accept an identity narrative that suggests that their nation has been wronged by others, you know, in the past or today. So I guess I focus more on the wider Al-Qaeda narrative. I don't think we're going to solve it just by undoing, if you will, or in some way backing out of Iraq and Afghanistan. Although I think, you know, the war in Iraq was an absolute disaster and made things much worse, much worse.
Carol, did you want to get in on this?
You know, we could speculate about their motives all day. We don't know. The interesting thing is that there's a Russian scholar who's at the Carnegie Center in Moscow, who's an expert on the North Caucasus, and he has a completely different hypothesis that I just think I should throw out there, that the, I guess it's ethnic stereotyping in some sense, that the Chechens and the people from the North Caucasus are very insulted by any kinds of derogatory comments that are made about them, and that somebody, his hypothesis is that somebody personally slighted either of the two brothers, and that that's what motivated the attack, because the Chechens have historically responded with great force. I just throw it out there because it's a completely alternative explanation given by somebody who really does study this part of the world. So,
Lord what, Taylor, is there someone possible?
Anyone else? Sir, I'm sorry, I neglected to ask the previous gentleman to identify himself. If you would, please.
My name is Alexander Rossolimo. I'm chairman of a think tank, the Center for Security and Social Progress. There seems to be confusion in the minds of many people about the nationality or ethnicity of the two alleged perpetrators. For instance, the Newton Tab today had an interview with a Russian-born resident of Newton. She was outraged that these two bombers were described as Russians, and perhaps recalling the poem by Mikhail Lermontov, the Kazakh lullaby. She said, no, they're not Russians, they're Chechens. And on the other hand, a couple of days after the marathon bombing, I think the president of Chechnya or Tajikistan said, no, they were, these two were influenced by America's culture, by the US environment, so they're not the Americans. And of course, they were both legal residents, and one of them was a citizen. So my question is, if you were to ask to characterize these by one term, what would you call them, if anything, nationality-wise?
Thank you.
Well, Elizabeth? Technically, they're half Chechen, half Avar. Their father is Chechen and their mother is Avar. But as we've seen, they grew up in four different parts of Russia and Kyrgyzstan, Kalmykia, Dagestan, Chechnya, and Kyrgyzstan, and Kazakhstan, probably. What I think is also interesting is to think of them, I'm going to shift the hypothesis about them yet again. What if we think of them, and this has been suggested by other people, as weak, wonderful discussion of the refugee deficit. They come in, they're unstable. They look for the most radical narrative they can find. If they had been Christians, they would have found a fundamentalist Christian narrative. So they find the jihadist Al-Qaeda narrative. But there's another piece of this, and I don't want to do conspiracy theories because we're not supposed to, but the question is who's interested in them defining this particular narrative? And it seems to me entirely, we have no idea. It was Tamerlan completely self-radicalizing? Entirely possible. Was he radicalizing because he met other jihadists from the Northern Caucasus? Also possible. A third possibility, which is remote, but I don't think we should completely discount it, is that the FSB somehow found him, knew he was weak, and sent him to radical jihadists. And so that there's also a possibility that the Russians are stirring this up as an excuse to then go in to Sochi. The fact is we probably will never know. It's possible that Jakhar will survive and he will talk about this, but I think we have to think of them not for their nationality, but for their fragility, for their vulnerability, for the fact that they then go to find the most radical. The mother was arrested for shoplifting outside of Lord and Taylor's. The bomb is dropped outside. One of the bombs was outside of Lord and Taylor's. Can we make that kind of psychological leap? We don't know. I think it's too far to go all the way to them wanting us to experience drones. But it's not too far to say them wanting to either buying into this jihadist network, language, or them wanting to inflict suffering in a way that's going to be very visible. I don't know. I pass it to Bakyt.
I personally used the Chechen background of two brothers in order to explain especially Tamerlan's beliefs, because without the Chechen history, because without his connection to his home country, Chechnya, and home country of his mother, Dagestan, it's very difficult to understand his beliefs and behavior. After that, if we take just two dimensions of their character, for instance, Johar is more American Chechen, but Tamerlan is more Chechen American, and he is less American. After that, I am a little bit skeptical about self-radicalization. I continue to think that he was in some way was influenced, manipulated. And he, in my view, he came, maybe he was the part of some kind of group where they discussed this kind of ideas. And after that, it was mentioned in press and media that he cannot understand Americans and he hasn't any friends among Americans. But he got married to an American girl from Suffolk University. How you can imagine this understanding that he dated with her? And he dated, and they spent a lot of time with her friends, Americans, with his friends, Americans, and so on. Therefore, I accepted these words from Tamerlan words just as exaggeration, and just as were, in my view, a little bit lightly used evidence of his alienation from the American society. I don't believe to that. And I think that he, if you pay attention to his just YouTube, all of his episodes, you will find that he paid a lot of attention to the Chechen culture. Chechen culture, which is very connected to Chechen Mujahideens. For instance, I listen almost all the songs of very famous Chechen singer Mutsuro, who, in my view, hugely influenced to his beliefs.
Silvia, did you want to add something?
No.
The room is listed to this side. Yes, sir.
Hello, my name is Abdi, and I'm a freshman here at MIT. After the week of the bombing and the tragic death of the officer.
I'm sorry, could you just speak up a little bit?
Yes. After the week of the bombing and the tragic death of the officer, a lot of people, specifically my friends, like the first question they would ask was, why did these two brothers do what, why did they do what they did? And like a lot of them were quick to just say that they're crazy, that they were, as like the uncle put it, losers. And like that, those kinds of answers never really satisfied me. So then I suggested that possibly there's some more global like influence. And the response I got from my friends, good people, but at that time had really strong emotions, was that I was profiling, I was showing some form of racism, which I thought was absurd because the brothers are Muslim, I'm Muslim. I wasn't being discriminatory, I was just considering that there could be a more complex answer. So my question may be directed towards Mr. Krause is, how do you fight this this environment where people, in trying to be tolerant, to almost neglect these other possibilities of motives in either a more global context or some other context?
Sure. So first off, I think you kind of hit the nail on the head in this, what I was trying to talk about in my speech, but maybe much more eloquently, which is you know, there's two kind of competing issues here, and I think one of the ways we deal with this stuff that's politically sensitive is to put our heads in the sand and just say, let's not talk about it because it's tough to talk about. And I think that's not the way to go. So I think, first and foremost, talking to your roommates or friends about it is a good thing. The second thing I will say is, I think that there's elements of what you're saying that I agree with, and I would look at the other side as well, which is, okay, on the one hand, I think that you can say
that someone could have a motivation or claim a motivation that's religious or political or whatever else, and we should be able to note that and study that and see to what extent that's an issue and that's something that the United States or otherwise as citizens we should consider, without having to then say, and therefore the people who are all share that ideology or religion or whatever else are therefore also a problem. That's not a leap that you have to make, but I think that that's probably how your friends or roommates are kind of saying that, because sometimes people do make that leap, right? They say, oh, well, this individual claimed that they committed the attack because the taxes are too high or because the U.S. invaded this country or whatever else. So therefore, anyone else who feels that way is a problem. Now, one of the things that I study, because I study social and national movements, is that most of the political violence that happens is not extreme in the sense of the objectives that it's for, it's the end. It's the means of how they're trying to achieve it. So much of the violence that happens like this, terrorist violence or otherwise, is not strange in the sense that it's trying to accomplish an objective that a lot of other people don't share. In fact, it's usually part of a broader community that shares that objective or that ideology or something else, but they're able to pursue it individually or peacefully or otherwise. And I think sometimes that's how these attacks, going back to the previous question about effectiveness, are actually very counterproductive. But what they do is they tar the name and the legitimacy of that broader movement, which many other people otherwise might think is quite legitimate. So one could have, you know, legitimate objectives again, objections to U.S. foreign policy, you know, on a variety of grounds, but still not support, you know, the killing of civilians in the United States to kind of, you know, fight against that, right? So I guess my answer, just in short, to what you were saying is, I don't think if these individuals, it turns out that, you know, they have this kind of jihadist ideology and they're saying that that's a reason that they did this or that's a problem. I think what Steve is talking about, to study this stuff, to understand what exactly the narrative is, to what extent we as citizens or as governments can deal with this stuff or grapple with it, I think that's important. But as I say, I would just be as passionate at dealing with, you know, things in the society where people who are going a step beyond that and being bigoted or racist against certain groups. To me, both of those are necessary to be able to get at this issue. If you just do one or the other, you're not going to get there, and that's when you get to either profiling in a way that's, you know, very counterproductive and not in line with what I consider to be U.S. values, or in the other way, which is you're kind of just saying, well, you know, this happens with all ideologies or whatever else, so I'm not really going to study it, or it's politically sensitive, so I don't want to talk about it. I don't think that's the way to go either.
Thank you.
Elizabeth?
Yeah, I just also wanted to add on this question. I think it's also very important that they come from a region where activists, again, people not always that we would think are very savory, are being murdered, assassinated on a weekly basis. So that fact, and for two reasons. One is the psychological effect of growing up in countries torn by violence. It affects the frontal lobes of the brain. And the other is that when you've seen all these people being killed, then your sense is, and we have evidence that Tamerlane was in Russia for 12 months from January to July. This is the period everyone's asking about. And in that period, two leading...
one of whom was a friend.
And one of them, this man Plotnikov, who has a similar biography, went to Canada, grew up in Canada, then becomes a terrorist in his own right. I'm not saying he's savory at all, but if there's a sort of domino effect, then I think that's also possible. And it helps to say, no, we're not saying all Muslims are bad. Far from it. We're saying that people who've become radicalized in very difficult circumstances, of course, are imbibing that impulse to violence, both because of the neurological effects on them, and this goes back to the drones. I mean, if we're dropping bombs on children growing up in countries, then we need to think about what it's like from the perspective of young people growing up there.
I think, Peter, when you were talking, I was thinking about the history of the Chechen wars themselves. That first Chechen war was not an Islamist undertaking in any way, shape, or form. It was a secular nationalist movement with an attack from Russia on Chechnya. I think there are people, even after the second Chechen war and the Islamicization of at least some of the fighters, I think that there are probably secular nationalists in Chechnya who share the objective of Chechen independence or, you know, getting rid of the Russians or whatever, who would not necessarily subscribe to the use of terrorism to accomplish that goal. And I think we need to be very, very careful about stereotyping, whether it's culture or all the Chechens are now Islamists and everything else, and I think we really need to be very nuanced in our discussion of the whole topic.
I think it's peculiar, though, and this is a question that I keep asking myself, why Boston, you know, of all places, or even why I can understand the Boston Marathon is very international, it's a happy day, but that's where the issue of what is the political goal here falters for me, because I could see if they got in a car and went to New York, or I can see other things to do, you know, or target a government building, or where, you know. But the thing about the marathon is it's a very happy time. So there's a certain darkness here, and I also think about, you know, Freud and the death instinct. You know, what is going on here that is so incredibly negative? And yet the counterbalance, of course, is the seeking of notoriety, fame. Fame is a value. And so that's why I quoted William James. The notion that you're split in two, from that notion that you're split in two and that there's tension, you can resolve that tension with some violent act. And this, by the way, is William James writes about that. And he says that violent act can be some cataclysm. It maybe takes you over and you can't even control it, but you will gain integrity because of this, or you will commit suicide, because suicide is the other resolution of that problem of the divided self. So I mean these are all imponderables, I think, at the moment.
Steve?
It's interesting, we have some disagreement about what motivated the attackers. I saw this from the very beginning as a standard al-Qaeda attack. It even fits the sort of cookie cutter that you'll find, you know, people describing the AQ method around the world. Strike a symbolic target, you know, Boston Marathon, you know, symbolic of American freedom, yada. Do it with careful thought given to the to camera angles, because it's all about PR. You know, they put the bombs in the place where the cameras would catch it most likely. The Al-Qaeda likes to do two things. They like first you hit this, then you hit that. They never attack, you know, with a single blow. Again, we saw the two bombs. It looked to me like they'd been kind of looking up stuff on the net as to how the standard AQ attack is carried out. And I think that the process by which they became radicalized followed closely the way we've seen others radicalized by their contact with Anwar al-Awlaki, who was the radical preacher in Yemen, who seems to have influenced Hassan, the guy who attacked Fort Hood, and he seems to have influenced the guy who attacked Times Square, tried to attack. So to me, this was looked to me like rather cookie-cutter standard al-Qaeda attack. And if so, religion has a lot to do with what happened here. I liked the question Adi asked. It's a great question, how to talk about this in the context of religion, and how to bring up the fact that there's a religious dimension here, and if we don't deal with it, we're not dealing with the reality. Now, I guess I'd say two things. One is, every religion has their crazies. Every religion has their crazies. And I think we need to have sort of a different discourse in the world in which the crazies of every faith are called to account and are held accountable, because they have to be. Now, how can we do that in a way that doesn't stigmatize or lead to blaming or scapegoating the larger faith of which they're part? These jihadis are a teeny weeny piece of the Muslim world. They're a minority within a minority. They're an extremely small segment of the whole. So it's very both inaccurate and immensely unfair to stigmatize the wider Muslim community for their actions. Same goes for the crazies in the Jewish world, the crazies in the Christian world. I mean, Christian world, so one of you mentioned that Timothy McVeigh had Christian affiliations. The truth is the entire U.S. militia movement is essentially formed around a perverted, deviant Christian sect. It started out as the sect was 100 years ago. It was known as British Israelism. It then sort of metastasized, or I don't know what you want to say the process was, into the so-called Christian identity movement, Christian identity philosophy. There's a terrific book by a guy named Barkin all about the Christian identity worldview, if you want to read it. The American media, I think, have done a huge disservice by not explaining that the Oklahoma City bombing and the related militia violence by the other militia movements, including the Montana militia, the Michigan militia, the other ugly militias, all emanated at root from a crazy Christian movement. And, you know, people don't want to be impolite and explain
Steve,
this as Christian.
Can I ask you a question, though?
Yeah.
Do you think that the two brothers were part of a group? That's the difference.
I don't think we know, but I think the primary channel for their radicalization was the internet.
Okay.
That's what I think. As we saw with these other guys I mentioned, Hassan and so on, these guys who were affected by al-Awlaki. So what's the suggestion? How shall we talk about this? One suggestion I've offered, Peter and I put it in an article some time ago, is we need an NGO that will serve the function of raising criticism against the use of religious authority for hate. The name I use for it is Religious Hate Watch, okay? Why not have an NGO that does the same thing in the area of religious hate that we have in the area of human rights, where Human Rights Watch tries to use naming and shaming to identify, call to account, and perhaps abate the use of religious, in that case, human rights abuses. We have Transparency Watch to call to account corrupt governments. To me, we need to have, if you will, a neutral player that is going to have a agreed universal standard for the comportment of religious communities to avoid the idea that when we call to account those who use God's authority for hate, that you're discriminating, that you're pointing the finger at one community. The idea would be, well, let's agree that every faith condemns this, and no faith wants to be used in this way, and every faith therefore agrees to support some kind of, shall we say, even standard that shall be applied to all faiths, that they shall not use religious authority for hate, and they shall take action against members in their community who do it.
Yes, sir.
By the way, I think that's a great suggestion, and it should get traction, Steve, without having to reinvent the wheel. With the Southern Poverty Law Center, for example, being a great example of folks who are working along those lines?
I'm really suggesting exactly that, that we take the Southern Poverty Law Center and somehow grow it global. That's what I would like to see happen.
Here's the question I wanted.
Could you identify yourself?
Oh, sure, Joseph Regna. This is the question I wanted to have folks address, if possible. Sylvia, you finished your presentation with the thought, and I'm paraphrasing, you know, what brings people to want to fight? And I know I'm not doing it justice, but I think it was something like that. And here's what I want to posit. You know, I could have drunk the jihadist Kool-Aid, and Steve did a great job of explaining what that is. I could totally understand the geopolitical context. You know, Carol and Elizabeth and Bayet, if I'm pronouncing your name correctly, also mentioned some of the background there. And I'm familiar with Peter's work from your stint at the Belfer Center. And, you know, Jeanne, of course, is always doing some great stuff. And Sylvia, I appreciated your refugee deficit concept as well. So all of that could be true. And yet, why go to violence? Don't we have options? So I'm pissed off because the group that I self-identify with has been on the short end of some stick. And I have a grievance. Why choose to bomb anybody? And why not seek some other quote-unquote nonviolent method of expressing my anger and rectifying the situation? Probably that's a question for another conference, but.
Well, we'll give it to Sylvia and see what.
You know, I think the majority of refugees do that, exactly what you're saying. I mean, most, you know, they end up doing whatever work they do that puts that kind of a motivation into something constructive as opposed to destructive. So I think that that's what happens on a regular basis in terms of refugee resettlement. You know, this really points out that there is a population we need to take, you know, more, observe more and take more, be more careful around, and that's adolescents. I think that adolescents, when they come in the middle of their identity development, I think it can, that in itself is already problematic. So if they come already with some ideology, and then there's a much more radicalized way of looking at that ideology because they were already Muslim. Much shorter jump to go to a narrative of Al Qaeda narrative, as Steve mentioned before. So I think that I think most refugees deal with that in a very productive way. I don't think that the majority of them don't do these things. But I think that for some, this is the kind of situation that will result.
If I could just add a thought, Joseph, it's a great question, great point. And my view is that extreme events and extreme behaviors almost always have multiple causes, and all usually multiple interacting causes. So I don't mean to suggest when I point to the jihadi narrative that it was the sole cause. I think it was that was a key factor. Without it, there would have been no attack. But factors that Sylvia's pointing to as well, the trauma that these folks suffered, both as your concept of refugee deficit, I'd never thought of it before, but that's fascinating, or the adolescents coming and not integrating and being alienated, or Jeanne's whole point about psychology, and perhaps we're dealing to some degree with psychopathy here, or sociopath conduct, folks who enjoy violence. You understand Hitler's violence? Well, you have to understand he was an anti-Semite. He also enjoyed killing people. These two things have to fit together to understand the Holocaust, in my opinion. So I think we had a number of causes here, and they were each necessary but insufficient to bring about what happened.
Please, Bakyt.
When we, from my experience, when we approach to this kind of people with a claim that why you go to violence, why not our more peaceful means, it's a first mistake. Because you would like apply to them your own version of reality, but their version of reality is different from you. And first of all, it's important to understand their worldview, their beliefs, their version of reality. And I do believe that one recommendation is merit of our attention, because this is radical jihad could be defeated by the beliefs which is close to the Islam, but will be more powerful and more inspiring, and which can turn the minds of the people to a more positive way.
Thank you.
I think it's a great question, the issue of violence. In neurobiology now, of course, there are the studies of the brains of the murderers. It's rather famous. There's a new book out about it. But I think that's an overly simplistic approach. But there is something that does go on that differentiates one person from another. A lot of people suffer as refugees, or they suffer in their lives, but they don't get violent. And so I think there is that larger context. The glorification of violence, by the way, if you're in a militarized society, that's an identity. That becomes an identity. So legitimate killing. We have legitimate killing. So why not have another way? Why not look for other ways? Peace, I think, is a good idea. I think Steve's on to peace, and I think that's it.
Yes, sir.
Sorry, Steve Whitaker. So just following up on the previous question, another way of looking at it and follow up on where it takes us is, so the other question is, why not turn to violence? So if you look at a lot of conflicts, the Palestinian conflict, for example, that was one where, if that had happened here, we would clearly have turned to violence. And the Palestinian conflict, for example. There's no way that we would have allowed an external power to kind of drop a nation on top of us without turning to violence. The Revolutionary War shows that, etc. So one of the things that's surprising is why there isn't more violence that emerges from these types of things, when if you look at some of the conflicts during the 70s and 80s, where groups said, okay, it's not working at home, we're going to take that conflict to the people that could intervene. So the Palestinians took it to Europe, and it turned out we didn't care anyway, so it failed. But that kind of the kind of Caucasus is in a region where, to some extent, the Al-Qaeda narrative that we've allowed disastrous things to be done to them by bad people, suggesting it's surprising that that hasn't been brought to our doorstep. So the follow-on question for that is, if you look around the rest of the world where you say, okay, there are other places kind of like this, where can we expect similar things to come from in the future? Is it places in Africa? Is it Indonesia? Is it Timor? It just suggests me that the violent, we use violence as states very effectively, but we kind of expect non-state actors not to use violence as a technique against us when it can be shown to be effective. So how do we even think about that in a world that becomes more volatile, where there are more movement of people from more areas where there's conflict and tension?
Thanks.
I still think the odd part here is that these are Chechens attacking the United States. It's not a typical, for all the incursions of Wahhabism and Salafism in that region, it's still very odd that the Chechens chose Boston. And so
I have to say that, you know, it's, I don't think that all these regions of the world are necessarily, I mean, it's a good question, but I don't think they're all going to necessarily end up in Boston. I think it's more plausible that these were very, very unstable individuals, and that's, because historically the Chechens have no beef with the United States that I know of. Go ahead, Peter.
A couple of points. So, I mean, one is going back to the point you just made and one before by Jeanne. So like 90-95% of terrorist attacks are committed locally within a few miles of where people are living or growing up. So a lot of this is just, you know, if these people want to commit an attack, it's a target of convenience. So it's not necessarily they looked on a map and they thought, what is the best possible target I can strike, the Boston Marathon? It's I grew up and I live around Watertown or wherever else, and oh, what's a big thing close by? Okay, the Boston Marathon, that's a good soft target, I can hit that. It'll have some of the elements that Steve's talking about in terms of notoriety, you know, public cameras, et cetera, though again, if you look at it from another context, it was one of the worst targets these people could possibly have picked because A, they got on camera immediately and are caught immediately. B, they're morons who attack a freaking marathon that happens every year. And what is a marathon? A marathon is a time when a community comes together. You sit there on the side of the road cheering people you've never met in your entire life, regardless of their religion or ethnicity or whatever else. And this is exactly the type of thing that brings a community together and makes it resilient, which is exactly the way you would not want to strike if you were trying to divide a community or have other some type of broader political impact. So I think in one sense, the biggest argument to me that makes sense is it's a target of convenience and it's not something dreamed up by a group or even these individuals as being the best one. It's one close by them they could hit, but again, they weren't the brightest bulbs in the box, in my opinion, in the sense that they picked a target that I think is actually going to, in the end, make sure that their memory is not going to be a good one, is going to actually strengthen this community. So that's one point. In terms of talking about them as Chechen or whatever else, I think that this is where getting to talking about their identity versus what they were doing can get difficult, because I totally agree with the point that, you know, if you're a nationalist Chechenian or whatever else, this would be a terrible attack. You would never want to do this. Why would you bring another enemy? That makes no sense from the nationalist angle whatsoever. But it is important to note that ethnic Chechens have been fighting in Al-Qaeda and other Al-Qaeda-linked groups for a while. There have been groups from Al-Qaeda, et cetera, have been fighting in Chechnya. So it's not out of the realm of possibility that there are individuals from this ethnicity who have been fighting in some of these groups elsewhere and whatnot. If you look actually in Afghanistan, some of the most effective and fiercest fighters in Al-Qaeda and some of the Taliban-related groups were Chechnyan. So on the one sense, I totally agree with the point that it doesn't necessarily mean because they are Chechenian they did this. It could be for personal reasons. I hadn't thought through the Lauren Taylor thing, but that's somewhat interesting. Nonetheless, I would say long and short, to me, the target of convenience, perhaps still being inspired by some broader jihadi ideology, makes the most sense. But in terms of why people commit violence, I've already talked too long, so I won't say more about that. But one thing I would say real quick is organizational competition is a big one. So if you think about when this stuff happens and when it really gets tricked up to a high level, you get into a context where you have multiple organizations in Chechnya fighting against the Russians, or in the Palestinian context, multiple organizations who are not just trying to fight the Israelis or fighting the Russians, they're also competing with each other for kind of market share, popular support, et cetera. That's when you see more and more extreme attacks and higher numbers, so these groups can kind of stick out to their base to get more support. So that is one of the things we do know that does make a difference.
Yes.
Hi, my name is Sappho Gilbert. I'm an undergrad student, political science minor. I guess one of the questions I have doesn't relate so much to the geopolitical or the religious type arguments, but in terms of a case-by-case basis, we do get a lot of intelligence coming our way from other countries, and it has been reported that Russia had reached out to the United States. We are a country that, since 9/11, has tried to balance both individual liberties but also national security. I'm just curious, what type of policy outcome change do you think might happen, or what would be more effective in balancing these two values that we do hold dearly, particularly given the terrorist acts of the past two decades, I would say?
Thanks. Anyone want to, Peter, you spoke to that a bit earlier.
Sure, yeah. I feel like I'm talking too much, but I'll say quickly. That's a great question. To me, that is the central question we have to face as a society. I mean, not just on the Boston attacks, but in general. And it doesn't just have to be a choice. Sometimes it's presented as a false choice. We can have more security, you can have more freedom. You know, you can make a pretty strong argument that having more freedom might also make you more secure, because again, it makes people feel more integrated in society. They're not feel like they're being profiled, et cetera. So it doesn't have to be one or the other. But I do think there is a tension to some degree. And as I said, with, you know, video cameras or drones or giving people access to emails and these types of things. Every society has to make these choices, and you can look around the world and people have made different choices. I mean, the way that Israel conducts itself versus the United States versus London and the British is actually quite different on a number of these areas. So I guess what I would say in terms of what I expect to happen as a result of just Boston, I really do think we're going to have more video cameras guaranteed, almost guaranteed downtown here. It's going to become more of the way it is in London. I think that that's something that overall American people on polling seem to be supportive of, or at least not really strongly anti. I think that will happen. And the thing that I'm very interested to see is the extent to which you are going to see something like this lockdown happen the next time something like this occurs. And I think that it will depend in large part on the size of the city and who's running it. Because if you remember back when we had the snowstorm this winter, it was illegal to go on the highways, right? I know someone who got arrested for driving on the highway during the snowstorm. So to some degree, it can just also be the governor, whoever's in charge, kind of seeing this as a good way to go. But I also think that Boston might be the biggest possible city, you know, it's often called like the biggest small town in America, that could actually have this happen, because I just don't think physically you could do something like what happened here in New York, like a lockdown or something like that. So that doesn't mean that it shouldn't be debated. I just think that it gets to the realm of impossibility to be able to do that. But long and short of it is, I think emails, domestic drones, these types of things, services like the FBI and CIA will push for this stuff. Because from their opportunity, they have a job they have to do. They want to have all the technology they can to try to do it. That doesn't mean that that's necessarily wrong, but it doesn't mean as citizens, we're the ones who actually get to decide that. So I would just encourage you to think about this stuff, and whatever your opinion is, you know, make sure it's heard, because a lot of times when mistakes like this gets made, it's because, oh, we can just trust who's ever running things that they'll know the right thing to do, and they can just have, you know, unlimited power to do this type of thing. And that's where I think we really run into trouble.
Yeah, I wanted to comment on that. I had a reporter ask me recently why the first suspect in the recent mailings of these ricin letters was actually shackled and then chained to a chair while he was being interrogated by the FBI. And the only answer I could give back was they don't think it's just a crime. They think it's a national security issue. You see, that person, it turned out it was the wrong man, right? Yeah. But they thought he had sent a dangerous letter to President Obama, to a member of Congress, and then to a sitting judge. So this is the fascinating thing about the FBI, because you see them, and you saw it after 9/11, the breaking down of doors and the absolutely rogue, you know, behavior on the part of field agents who had in their minds not criminality, but national security. So see, it ups everything. And Peter, absolutely right. It ups everything. And by the way, your budget is really much more secure. Your budget is really better off. All the years that the FBI put white collar crime at the top, nothing compared to now. Counterterrorism is at the top, national security and intelligence are at the top, and the budget is actually much more secure, because that's the last thing that you're really going to get rid of.
Anyone else want to speak to the trade-off, notional trade-off between security and freedom?
Yeah.
I guess I'd like to ask the panel, maybe Peter in particular, what grades do you give the Bush administration and the Obama administration across the board on how they handled this trade-off? You were speaking really to the issue of surveillance, but
sure.
During the Bush administration, we also saw the administration engage in warrantless wiretaps, despite the fact that they had a legal framework for conducting these wiretaps. They chose to break the law and do them illegally. We saw the Obama administration recently affirm the right of the president to declare somebody to be a terrorist combatant and arrest them without any due process.
Yeah. Well, John McCain said it today. There's an op-ed in the Globe. John McCain and two senators saying that we should treat Jihad and this 19-year-old kid as an enemy combatant.
Right.
So, it's still, sorry.
and Guantanamo and a couple of others.
And then the entire use of torture, which was really quite remarkable and, you know, really had no precedent in American history. And I would say, number one, the torture happened and became a routine instrument of American counterterror. And number two, the Obama administration has not prosecuted anybody for this massive violation of law. What grades do you give?
It's a tough question. I guess I just became a professor, so now I have to give grades, right? Steve, I used to just get grades from Steve, and that was much easier. So a real quick point I would just say to that, and then I'll answer the question, is I just want to be clear. The FBI and these organizations that are doing this stuff, I think, have overstepped their bounds in a number of ways. But I'll also say that we as a public are not innocent here. If The FBI does not publish those photos. And those guys then go on to New York, as some people say they might have, and kill more people. The very first thing that's going to happen is Congress is going to haul the FBI before them and say, what were you guys doing? You had these photos. You didn't release them to the public. We are demanding transparency. Every media organization is on your door demanding this stuff. So I just want to say that, you know, on the one hand, we're criticizing them, and I think in fair terms, but it's also fair to understand that they're under enormous pressure by people like us to demand this type of information. And they have tough decisions just as we do. So I'll add that real quick. In terms of, you know, the grades, I would say, first and foremost as a caveat, one of the most interesting things to me is how hard the Obama administration criticized the Bush administration before coming into office and all the things you mentioned, Steve, and then how similarly they acted when they were there, which makes me ask a couple of questions. One, is there information that we don't know without having a security clearance that they have access to and Obama sees much more than he did before and decides these are the right decisions? I'm not sure. Two, is it simply the fact that he decides politically this is what the American people are willing to accept? As much as there was anger at Guantanamo, whatever else, he realizes that there is a minority in the U.S. that gets very agitated about this, but the majority is kind of don't ask, don't tell, or don't want to talk about it, and so he decides he wants to deal with bigger fish to fry like healthcare or something else. I'm not sure. In terms of my grades for what he's done, I think a lot of it comes down to questions that I'm not sure if I have 100% answer to, which is whether torture is actually effective for getting information. I generally have a bias towards the fact that I don't think that it is, but I also am open to the fact that I think there probably are cases where it has worked, but that doesn't mean the broader question of is the cost of doing that, what it means to human rights and the way we're seen in society might be not worth even the small benefits it gets every once in a while. So in that sense, I'd say incomplete because I don't know. In terms of broader grades about foreign policy, to the extent that this gentleman's question and others about U.S. foreign policy play a role here, and I think that they do, drawing down forces in Iraq and Afghanistan and not kind of chasing the brass ring that supposedly is always just around the bend and doesn't seem to get any better, I think, is a positive. And so I think he gets higher marks for that. But I think a lot of these other issues, he just had a speech yesterday, right, at the press conference about closing Guantanamo and how this is still something he aspires to do, especially with this growing hunger strike there, but that has not done. I think he really does want to do it. I just think there's huge political and legal issues to do it, and I'm not sure of the pathway to get there. So again, I feel like I'm punting on all this stuff, but borderline incomplete, you know, maybe a high marks for effort to the extent that you think that's a good idea, but low marks for delivery. I'm not sure.
Yeah.
We don't know his curve.
Thank you.
Sir, please identify yourself.
Rick Shaw. Is this on?
It is.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Face recognition is not on, right? Rick Shaw from here. Two bits that I don't hear talked about too much. The probability that perhaps this was just a demo for another entity somewhere else, and that they chose at least the legal designation of Patriots Day to perform the demo on.
Is there a question?
No.
Okay, sir?
Alec Wood, and I think my question is probably directed to you, Peter. You just mentioned that the two suspects had planned to explode the remaining bombs they had, or pipe bombs,
not
or
sure
allegedly,
that, that's a potential.
Allegedly, in New York City. But my question is, an official in New York City made the comment that these individuals wouldn't even get across the Tappan Zee Bridge or the George Washington Bridge, wouldn't get to Times Square, wouldn't have been able to perpetrate the bombs. And my question is, within what is in the public domain, can you comment on what security New York City may have in place that other cities would want to emulate?
Yeah, well, they absolutely, I mean, Times Square is one of the most, you know, guarded places, public spaces in the United States, and I think that the comments that I saw, I don't know if you're talking about Bloomberg or other people's comments, but the ones I saw about saying, yes, you know, we know this is a target all the time, and so we're always watching it, I think is true. To the comment that they wouldn't have even gotten there, I mean, Faisal Shahzad got there with a car full of explosives, and thank God the detonator didn't work. But if it had, we would have had large numbers of deaths in Times Square just a few years ago. So it's not like it just in the past couple of years, I think they've really stepped things up even more. I mean, I'm sure after that failed attempt, they have a bit, but that's almost 10 years after 9/11. So again, the difficulty of a lone individual who, you know, has access or ability to build a bomb, which unfortunately, even though a lot of these people have failed, is not as difficult as we all might think. this is one of those things we're just going to unfortunately have to deal with to some degree as a free society. I think that we can lessen the risk, but you know, the bravado that this would never have happened, I think, is more of a political point than reality. I think, unfortunately, we've seen again and again people like this have been able to slip through the nets. It's not like the Boston Marathon finish line was, had low amounts of security. There were police officers all over the place there, and yet we're not searching every single person's backpack who's coming in there, and if you're not doing that, this is possible.
By the way, about New York, New York is absolutely amazing. It has more security structure in terms of every federal organization you could imagine, Homeland Security, and certainly the FBI has its own really almost independent office there, and just an incredible network, in addition to the fact that the police force of New York is, 30,000 people? I mean, 30,000 policemen in New York is absolutely amazing. I can't think of another city in the world, but you're right. Is it perfect? Is it always going to work? And no, it can't protect you. But we do have this expectation, you know, of what people in the sciences call equilibrium. We keep thinking that society is going to be in a state of equilibrium. Actually, society is dynamic. It's in constant state of disequilibrium. Bad things happen. We do have this, I think we get used to orderly lives. And we have expectations that these lives are going to be totally, or nothing's going to disrupt us. And then there's another thing that's also happening with us. And I'm reacting here to a book I read recently by a man named Matt Ridley. It's on rational optimism. Why do we keep acting as if there's more violence now than, let's say, 25 or 30 years ago, when in fact the violence curve is down? Why do we keep acting as if our lives are at constant risk? We've never been in better health on the planet. And the book is 800 pages long, and he goes over everything that is better. Now, it's not great and it's not perfect, right? But it's better. And we've had this with Steven Pinker, by the way. Mary Caldor, a wonderful writer on military and political issues, made this argument about 5 or 6 years ago. It's actually better, but we don't think it's better. And we get very concentrated on risk, national security, looking here and there, you know. And we're going to be, I tell you, the other day, I was coming here on the T, and there was a fellow with dark hair who had a black backpack on. Well, how did I think about that? Well, I moved away, see? So that's part of the resonance. That's part of being coerced by these events. But in general, we're actually doing pretty well. You know, what I'm saying here, we shouldn't really be succumbing to fear. I guess that's really what I'm saying.
Let's try to get a couple more questions in. Yes.
Hi, I'm a 2013 graduate of the MIT Sloan School. After so much talk about the global context, I'm wondering what role you see in education, given that we've talked about not fearing the other, about understanding that there's radicals in every religion and that there's not something inherent in Islam that predisposes Muslims to violence, and about the refugee deficit and how important it is to assimilate and integrate and welcome people who may be feeling a sense of otherness. What role arts education, avenues for creative self-expression, we should be thinking about in our schools, given their non-security, that they are not the FBI, what role does education play in this global context for you?
Who wants to take that? Sylvia, your comments
are closest. Education, are you thinking in terms of like elementary school, high school?
I am. I'm thinking of K-12, of creating more educated citizens that don't jump to illogical and stereotypes, and that may create a better society that doesn't breed these sort of actions, both the initial action and perhaps uninformed responses like we've been hearing.
Yeah, well, you know, my son goes to the Cambridge French and Latin School. And, you know, I think that there are places like Cambridge and Latin which do a really good job at exactly that. I mean, one of the things, if I remember well, reading some years ago when they were trying to figure out what words to use for the high school, the kids came up with the words, and they were opportunity and respect were two of the three words. I don't remember the third one, but you know, you can't create these kind of environments. I'm not saying that that's a panacea and that it works really well for all children there, but You can't create environments where people are respected, where kids are respected, no matter where they come from, where they're not necessarily bullied, for example, or made fun of because they are foreigners or because they are immigrants or because they don't speak English or whatever that question may be. So I do think that there's a role for education, and I think that establishing those types of environments where where kids are taught to be more respectful of difference go a long way. But it's also helpful to have environments where there's heterogeneity. You know, if you're in a lot of environments in education in the United States, there's a lot of segregation, and you end up with very homogeneous environments where people don't have access to people who are different from them, and who don't necessarily know how to respect people who are different. Mm-hmm. So you know, there's this is something that really has to come down to being in situations where people have a lot of contact with people who are not like them. And that only happens in situations where there's more heterogeneity.
I just want to make a quick plug for a program called Facing History that's done in the middle and high school kids, teaching kids to look at situations of atrocity and move out of what Silvia so wisely remarked on as the American tendency toward naivete. And so I think if you've studied the Gulag in the Soviet period, then you hear about Guantanamo or Abu Ghraib, it creates a different response if you've actually studied people who've suffered in that kind of thing.
Your question also raised in me the question of whether anything can be done in terms of education or life or whatever in these places where people like the Tsarnaev brothers come from. And certainly in Dagestan and Chechnya, the Russians talk a good game, but because of the corruption and everything else, nothing's happening. There is no... there's no peaceful context in which these kids or, you know, their relatives have grown up and are thriving because of the endemic violence, and people, any money that's given from the center is pocketed by some official somewhere. And I think that goes across the board, I think, through both the post-Soviet space and certainly beyond.
Thanks. Yes, sir.
Yeah, so I almost hate to bring up this
Please
issue.
Identify yourself.
Yes. The name is Bob Rosenberg, and involved in business and also international relations for over 20 years. You touched also on the issue not only of the physical security and dealing with individuals who might be dangerous, but there's also the fact that after 9/11, a lot of laws were put in place that don't have the safeguards that other things do for the citizens of this country. And so I'd like to see that be part of this discussion as well. Obviously not much time now, but maybe for a future discussion.
Thank you. Well, we have time for the two folks who are at the microphones. Why don't I ask you each to ask your question? I'll turn it over to the panel. I'll let those who feel like they want to respond, and then I'll thank everyone for coming. So why don't we go here and then there?
Sure. I just arrived. I'm not sure if this question has been addressed, but along the lines of education, I decided to educate myself the other day, and I looked up Google and Bing. This is MIT, so numbers should matter. I wanted to find out how many bombing sorties US/NATO planes performed in Libya. And the number is about 8,500 sorties that the bombs were dropped. And when you look at the pictures of the bombs exploding, approximately 15,000 bombs, each bomb that exploded in Libya is about 100 times more powerful than average pressure cooker bomb. And I do remember Obama criticized Bush government by being the warmonger, and then he received the Peace Prize, Nobel Peace Prize, and then we still dropped 15,000, the best bombs we could ever make in a country called Libya. How can you explain this?
Okay, first question, last question.
Okay, my name is Kim Sergen. I teach in women and gender studies, and I'm currently teaching class on gender and technology, but I also teach gender and media, so we've been following a lot of these questions, and I'm interested in the relationship between the surveillance issue and the civil liberties issue, but particularly if anybody is making any connections with CISPA, because this was passed by the House on Thursday, the cyber Intelligence Sharing and Protection Act, which is essentially warrantless searching. And I'm wondering, you know, I mean, obviously the Senate has not agreed to hear it. In some ways, I think this is related to the question of Bush versus Obama, right? Because Obama at least has come out with this sort of veto threat and a statement today on that we need to have a more attention to privacy. But I guess I'm wondering if, you know, if there's more of a need to make connections between these sorts of laws, which are, you know, originally framed as specifically against cyber terrorism, but which are getting kind of blanketly, you know, brought in to address other issues like child porn. Again, national security becomes a button, and what the implications are. I'm particularly interested if anybody has been following the issue of the deleted Instagram account, and you know why we might even be interested in having warrantless searches when it seems that the government could easily reasonably justify recovering an Instagram account without having to do these backdoor sorts of investigations. That was one issue. The other two, really quick, the issue of change versus you know, kind of, I mean, we saw they picked the wrong city, right? In editorial in the New York Times, and whether making any changes in the name of security is actually capitulating, right, to the fear, such as maybe you suggested by moving away from the person with the backpack, right? But I spend a lot of time in Philadelphia, and the Philadelphia Broad Street Run, which is coming up this Sunday, they've made dramatic changes. They won't allow any bags in. All the runner bags have to be transparent. And whether, you know, is there a balance between common sense and, you know, fear or capitulation? And finally, if there's any connection to be made between the boxing and the violence in boxing and this action.
Okay, thank you. Let me turn it back to the panel. Anyone want to respond either to the questions or offer final summary remarks? It's up to you. Peter?
Sure. Real quick to the Libya point. So there's a great dissertation that was written by a student from MIT named Brendan Green talking about intervention and saying, well, the Democrats and Republicans really disagree about foreign policy in the sense that they both want to intervene but for different reasons. And so Republicans often really want to intervene, you know, for regime change or, you know, kind of along the lines with what President Bush did in Iraq. The Obama administration, some of the people who support him, like Susan Rice and Samantha Power, they really want to intervene as well. They just want to do it for humanitarian reasons, so stopping a genocide or things of this nature. So at the end of the day, you could say, well, you know, the Obama administration criticized the Bush administration on this, yet they intervened quite a bit. And I think you can generally say, looking at the debates between Obama and Romney on this stuff, a lot of differences on domestic policy, foreign policy, they seem to get along pretty well. Now, you can agree or disagree with that, but you know that's an important point. In terms of the U.S. dropping those bombs, I mean, what the Obama administration and supporters of that would say is, yes, but the reason for that is because the Gaddafi regime is hopefully not one that you would necessarily support, and this was designed to try to remove him from power. Now, you could say, well, violence in any context is not worthwhile, and that's a stance that you know many people, pacifists or otherwise, might support, but that would be the stance of the government. In terms of the point about you know, trading off of liberties and whether we're, you know, being too fearful in this stuff, I think there's a couple key things. One is whether you're doing something for the short term or it's kind of a long-term policy. So I understand to some degree right after an attack, you know, like the London Marathon or something that happens, they have slightly stepped up security issues just because they're worried about a copycat or someone else doing it right after that. Whereas if Philadelphia going forward has a policy of no bags in their marathon 5 years from now, I would see that as a major problem. This time, I would still maybe see that might be a bit of overkill, but there's kind of short-term versus long-term how you do this. You still have to be concerned about precedent, but that's something. In terms of being fearful, I would echo Jean's point as well, which is I don't think that we should have necessarily no reaction to these attacks, because at the end of the day, we should be deciding as a society what's a threat and trying to protect ourselves. But we shouldn't act out of fear, and hopefully the knowledge of how many people are actually killed in these attacks, how likely you are to be killed by a terrorist attack versus a car accident or a lightning strike or, you know, homicide with a gun, which is an issue that wasn't brought up here but, you know, is in the news because of Newtown and these types of things. Hopefully at least makes you feel like this is a scary proposition that you could be targeted for any reason. You can't control it, and I think that's one of the reasons we get more scared about terrorism than, say, you know, other things. But long and short of it is, at least as of now, until if and when terrorist groups or non-state groups get access to, you know, nuclear weapons or things like this, the likelihood of them being able to cause mass death is thankfully still quite low. And so we should be able to still have reasoned debates and discussions about these things and recognize that there are a lot of great things about this country and the liberties we have that we shouldn't be so quick to kind of dispense with.
Anyone else want to?
I could say something about the boxing. I understand that it was his father that taught him to box and got him, you know, into boxing and really pushed him. I also understand that he was quite a character that, you know, I think boxing for him was this whole thing. It wasn't just, you know, getting rid of, you know, whatever aggression he may have had. But nevertheless, he would wear furs, like white furs, and he would appear in very artistically different kinds of ways in the to all of the bouts, et cetera, et cetera. So he was building a whole persona around his boxing that I think allowed him to have a particular type of identity, which I think he was very much wanting. So I think that boxing, in a way, can keep you from being violent to other people if you're somebody who's very aggressive. Or it can just be a way of getting ahead. You know, I mean, this is, you know, if you have if you can, it's usually people who are disfranchised who go into boxing. It's not people who are middle class or who have possibilities. So, you know, there's different reasons for boxing. But I think for him, I'm kind of like, you know, sorry that he wasn't allowed to go on boxing, because maybe he would have been okay with that. I don't know. There's all these other things that could have come in between, but he was definitely very interested and really wanted to build a persona around the boxing.
There's an MIT boxing club.
Okay, does anyone else have a final word that they want to share? You know, we do these star forums on a regular basis, but we've never done one in my memory for 3 hours, and I want to thank you. This could have continued. And in fact, I was just cutting this gentleman off. I apologize, but thank the panel with me. And thank the real organizer, Michelle. Thank you very much. And Rebecca, where is she? Is she here? Thank you all very much for coming.